CBS. Welcome home.
The most compelling action is on CBS Sports.
Texas, the place where everything's big. Big old animals running freely over big old ranges. And the owners of the big open spaces have big old dreams. One of the biggest comes to realization today as the brand new Texas Motor Speedway hosts its inaugural Winston Cup race, the Interstate Batteries 500. Among those looking to tame this tough new Texas track will be the Intimidator Dale Earnhardt, Daytona winner Jeff Gordon, point leader Dale Jarrett, and of course, Texas Terry Labonte. Over 40 cars will lock horns at the start. But on the winner's trophy, only one name will be branded. The inaugural Texas Interstate Batteries 500 next on CBS Sports.
Texas Motor Speedway, opening day. Interstate Batteries 500. 150,000 seats sold. 194 suites filled. 43 competitors ready to battle for $3.8 million on this $120 million racing facility. It is some kind of day for Winston Cup racing. Outside, the scene here in Texas, a new experience for these folks, is the same that you see at any Winston Cup race. Almost. Yeah, there's a few things different. But generally, there's the excitement, there's the electricity. As the big cars and the big stars get ready to go for it, 500 miles of racing today into the unknown on a new super speedway, and a great one. Let's meet two of the principals, the Corpus Christi Comets themselves, the Labonte brothers, there with Mike Joy.
Ken, the Labonte brothers and Bobby Hillen are the Texas natives in this field. See that map of Texas up here on the roof of Terry's car. The last time Winston Cup racing came to the Lone Star State, Terry Labonte sat on the pole. And today, after a run in the 300-miler yesterday, what do you expect this afternoon?
I'll tell you what, it's going to be a tough race, no question about it. Our Kellogg Chevy ran pretty good in the last practice, so I don't know. I think we feel pretty good about it, but it's going to be a tough one.
Will it take a lot of give and take today to be there at the end, Terry?
Oh, I think so. It's awful hard to pass. Yeah, you're going to have to be pretty cautious, I think.
Okay, good luck. Now, right alongside in this second row, his younger brother, Bobby Labonte. And with a window net up, let me snake an arm in here. And Bobby, how about it? After yesterday's run here, what do you think about this afternoon?
Well, I tell you, the Interstate Pontiac was running real good in practice yesterday and qualified fourth. Imagine that. So we're looking forward to today's race. We got a lot to look forward to with Interstate sponsoring the race. And yesterday's Shell Pontiac, we ran good for a while and had a little trouble and didn't finish like we wanted to, but learned a lot about the racetrack.
Labonte's hope to keep some of Bruton Smith's money here in Texas today. Let's go back to Dick Bergeron.
Dale Jarrett is the hottest driver in the series so far this year. He has led more laps than anybody else. He has won two races. He is on top of the points. And today he starts from the pole. But this racetrack, although it's brand new, it is like no other. It has a reputation. It has an attitude. How do you tackle this place today, Dale?
You're just going to have to be careful. There's only a very few places that you can even attempt to pass. You don't want to get out of the groove very little, and this is just a difficult place. Demands all the respect of a place that we raced for a lot of years, like Darlington, and you're going to have to show this place that same respect.
He's got a good car to run this race with. It has won the last two races in a row. To Ralph Shaheen.
Dick, you know, when it comes to getting acclimated to a new racetrack, not a problem for Rusty Wallace. He won the first ever race in New Hampshire National Speedway in 93, and you won the first race in Suzuka, Japan this past fall, and you were the fastest guy during all the pre-race testing here at Texas. What have you learned from all that to help you win here today?
Well, I've learned a lot, I think. I mean, this track is going to be a real tough track to get around, I think. The passing is going to be real critical. Pit stops are going to be real critical. But after we get a second lane worked in this place, I think the passing is going to start happening. I'd like to be the first winner of it. There's no doubt about that. You know, it's like you said earlier, I won those other ones. But, man, it's big down here. A lot of people here, a lot of people really excited about racing in Texas, and I'm just glad we're here.
The Ken Squire, Rusty Wallace, will start ninth today.
Well, thank you, and welcome to your seat on the start-finish line for this great day in Winston Cup racing. I'm here with two-time Winston Cup champion Ned Jarrett. And, Ned, any ticket to a Winston Cup event is special, but to an inaugural event, that's the one you always remember, that very special first time, like when Johnny Mantz won at Darlington, or Lee Petty at Daytona, or Jeff Gordon at Indianapolis, the Brickyard 400. But today, it's a battle into the unknown once again for these great stars.
Certainly a lot of unknowns. They don't have the big, thick book of notes that they carry around after running at several tracks over the years, and they have nothing to fall back on. There's a lot of unknowns out here.
But there's one guy that does have an edge as we go into this race today.
I would say that would have to be Mark Martin. Mark did a lot of tire testing here for Goodyear, and yesterday took the lead late, passing Jimmy Spencer to go on to win the Busch Grand National race here. So certainly that was good experience for him. So going into this race, Ken, Mark Martin would have to be among the favorites.
The last three times that anyone has won back-to-back Saturday to Sunday has been this man, Mark Martin. Can he do it again today? He won yesterday. Now, as to the track itself, let's take a look at it. Turn 3 and 4 area. Here's Buddy Baker.
The drivers found out one thing at Texas Motor Speedway yesterday. You have to have give and take. Steve Park in the blue, number 3, found out the hard way you can't get too anxious on a give-and-take racetrack. Behind me, you can see that the groove started out only one car length wide. The shiny part is where they were running, right on the bottom of the racetrack, right left side tires, right on the white line. As the race went along, they found out that they could move up a full car width over to the right and really get off the corner a little bit better, but they lost just a little bit of traction getting in the corner, so it really didn't work in. But today in the 500, I look for the groove to move up another car length, and if I leave the set here, it's because I'm wearing leather shoes, and I might make the same mistake a driver does early in the race if they get up here.
Okay, Baker, slide right back up here to the booth. There's the man everybody's talking about outside of the front row, the winner of Daytona, Jeff Gordon, getting ready for this 500.
Dale Earnhardt hasn't won in over a year, Ken, but he's primed. He thinks this might be the race that he can turn around his 1997 season.
And if you're looking for a dark horse today, look at this young man, Jeff Burton. 3 top fives on the super speedways this year. The Virginian is going to be tough. Rule changes. They've changed again. Here's Mike Joy with a story.
Ken, I'm standing at Jeff Burton's car, and all these Ford Thunderbirds have scrape marks along the rear spoiler. NASCAR mandated after the last race that a quarter of an inch be reduced from the height of the spoiler. Now, after Atlanta, they also took another quarter of an inch. So this spoiler has 60%, or rather 60 pounds less downforce on the back of the car, about 10% reduction from what it had at the last race. And a lot of these Ford teams on this tricky handling racetrack are wondering how much of an effect that will have today as NASCAR seeks to achieve parity between the three competing makes. Ken?
The wondering is just about over. We're down to the start-finish line, and Bruton Smith, chairman of the board, ready to give the command.
The chairman of the board of Motor Speedway, Speedway Motorsports, Mr. Bruton Smith.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
For the first time, they're ready to race at Texas Motor Speedway. Engines coming alive. $3.8 million at stake. This is going to be a dandy. Stay with us for CBS flag-to-flag coverage today.
CBS Sports presentation of the Interstate Batteries 500 is sponsored by Pennzoil. Formulated for today's stop-and-go driving. Stop-go Pennzoil. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by the Ford F-150. Strength after strength after strength.
The anticipation building to a climax here as we're just about ready to pull the cork
on what should be a vintage event. Take a look at the weather today.
Perfect conditions, Ken. Temperature in the 60s, humidity very low, light wind, shouldn't affect the cars at all. The forecast is for clear weather this afternoon. Track temperature about 95, in-car temperature to start with about 98, but that'll run up in a hurry once they get to racing up to maybe 130.
6 inches of rain in 24 hours, and so there was no qualifying. The field is determined by postmarks and by points. The front row. Winner at Atlanta and Darlington this year, Dale Jarrett, and alongside the Daytona 500 champion, Jeff Gordon. In row two, the Texans, Texas Terry himself and younger brother Bobby Labonte. In row three, Jeff Burton and Mark Martin, who won yesterday in the Grand National race. Row four, Jeff Bodine and Ricky Rudd. For row five, the winner at Richmond last month, Rusty Wallace and Ernie Irvin. In row six, it's Ted Musgrave and Ward Burton. In row seven from Michigan, Johnny Benson Jr. and the 84-time Winston Cup winner, Darrell Waltrip. Row eight, the seven-time Winston Cup champion, Dale Earnhardt and Bill Elliott. In row nine, it's Bobby Hamilton and Todd Bodine. Row 10 is Morgan Shepherd and Jeremy Mayfield. Row 11, Michael Waltrip and the two-time Daytona 500 champion, Sterling Marlin. In row 12, Kyle Petty's there with Lake Speed. It's the leading rookie, Mike Skinner, on the inside. Brett Bodine outside of row 13. For row 14, there you have Kenny Schrader and Rick Bass. Looking at row 15, there's the brilliant Robbie Gordon and John Andretti, the two Indy racing car stars. Row 16 is Kenny Wallace and Dick Trickle. Row 17, Jimmy Spencer and Hut Strickland. For row 18, Steve Grissom is there with Dave Marcus. Row 19, Derek Cope and Chad Little. In row 20, it's Greg Sachs and Joe Nemechek. Row 21, Bobby Hillen Jr. of Midland, Texas. Mike Wallace with him. And out back, riding shotgun, Billy Stanbridge, as we get ready to turn them loose for 500 miles. Take a look at the composite of the field here today. They come up for those that failed to make the field first.
Unfortunately, they didn't have enough points or didn't get their entry in early enough. Bailey, Barrier, Bliss, Bradbury, Dollenbach, Green, LaJoy, Presley, and Wilson.
LaJoy had a big crash out here in practice and destroyed his Winston Cup car. Now the manufacturers break down.
There's 22 Fords today, 13 Chevrolets, and 8 Pontiacs making up the field today.
And there's your race analysis.
334 laps this race will be, 501 miles actually, with a purse of $3,802,000.
Wow. That? Hey, Ned, take us around this mile and a half track. They say it's like Charlotte.
Okay, here's the start-finish line. Go down to turn one. Had a little problem with the asphalt there the other day, but it's okay now. Go down the backstretch into 24 degrees of banking, turns three and four. Very tight here coming off of turn four. Also 24 degrees of banking down in turns one and two.
Looks easy, buddy.
Looks easy, very difficult. This racetrack will reach out and bite you if you make a bad mistake.
And it has bitten several. We had 8 cautions in that 300-miler yesterday, won by Mark Martin. Take a look at the in-cars for this race. And you're riding with Dale Jarrett. He's led 57% of the laps this year, and he failed to lead a lap at Daytona. What a job he's done. Number one in points, therefore on the pole.
And Jeff Gordon will be carrying a camera. He's starting on the outside pole here today.
Let's not forget, within striking distance of the point lead, you have Bobby Labonte. He'll be carrying a camera for us today.
And Jeff.
Bobby Labonte.
We're in the Joe Gibbs entry.
Yep.
And Jeff Burton carrying a camera in the X-side batteries forward. And Jeff has come very close to victory in Winston Cup. Wouldn't be surprised to see it happen today.
Well, here's my pick, Mark Martin, in that Valvoline Ford, looking for his fourth doubleheader sweep today. The last three times it's been done, that man, Mark Martin, pulled it off.
Well, Rusty Wallace ran awfully strong here in testing, Ken, in the Miller Lite Ford. He's very confident going into this race. Watch for him to have a good run.
Now, our final camera's being carried by Todd Bodine. It was to be carried by Ricky Craven. He's in the hospital, broken shoulder. He is better, still in the hospital today. They've discovered a couple of broken ribs. Some of his crew went over to see him last night. They said he was so disappointed he might not even watch the race today, not to be out here in competition.
Well, we hope you're watching and we hope you're feeling much better today. Newburgh, Maine's Ricky Craven and the Grand National point leader, Todd Bodine, is now in that car. Here's Mike Joy.
We last talked to Ray Evernham on the way to victory lane at Daytona. Jeff Gordon starts on the outside pole, wasn't in yesterday's race. What did you learn from that and yesterday's last practice?
Well, the track has got a lot of grip, so it's going to be tight. We hope it stays tight because we did a lot of things to loosen up, but it's going to be a race where you're going to have to adjust, Mike. You know, 500 miles, the track's going to change, more rubber's going to get down. It's a lot cooler, so it's going to have to be adjustable.
Well, is his young driver part of the 21st century or what? He's got his own website, folks. Ken?
24-degree turns here, Michael. Backstretch at Texas, 1,300 feet, 1,360 feet at Charlotte. Track they say it's similar to. One lap, and we're going to be racing the apex just a little wider about on this track. The start-finish line straight away, 850 feet, the double dog leg, and those short chutes, that's where there's the difference. The Texas short chute is 670 feet as opposed to Charlotte, which is 770.
And that 100 feet can make a lot of difference, Ken, in the way you approach the turn or this quad oval coming off of turn four and going into turn one. It's a tricky area for it.
Dick Bergeron.
Beware of the Pontiacs today. This is a downforce track, and NASCAR rules allow the Pontiac 3/4 of an inch more spoiler on the back than the Fords, 1/2 inch more than the Chevrolets. That produces downforce. In that last practice yesterday, quickest guy here, Kyle Petty in a Pontiac. Durrell.
Dick, Todd Bodine could be a factor here as well. Crew chief Andy Graves says that Todd's style of driving is much more like his teammate Terry Labonte, which of course Andy Graves helped bring to a national championship last year, unlike Ricky Craven's style, which is more like Jeff Gordon's.
Fords have won 3 races this year, Chevrolet's 2. Half a lap to green to get it underway, first time ever. Sold out, they got everybody in. They had a traffic line for about 17 miles earlier this morning, but remarkably, they pulled it off. They had to get 200 buses. 6 inches of rain made a disaster out of the parking lots, but today it's letter perfect all the way around.
Of course, as a result of the rain, there was no qualifying, as you mentioned earlier, but Ken, they would have qualified somewhere in the 185, 186 or 7 mile an hour bracket had they run qualifying.
Okay, out of four, down for the first time. Crowd up, standing on its feet. We're ready to go. Winston Cup Racing. Pace car speed today, about 60 miles an hour. Pit road speed will be 55. Field coming down. Jarrett and Gordon lined up, and it is Dale Jarrett through the gears and jumping out in front.
Well, you can see everybody trying to get in single file right at the first of the race. There's a lot of debris on the racetrack, a lot of sand. Trouble. Turn one.
Big crash in the center of the field. Collecting 2-3 cars as they broke away that have really been hammered, several others involved.
Caution is out, but Jarrett and Gordon want to win the first lap, lead the first lap here at the Texas Motor Speedway, but the caution is out, so they won't race that hard. They know that there's trouble down in turn one, so Jarrett will lead.
Well, you saw Morgan Shepherd's number one wrecked. You saw the car of Darrell Waltrip, the number 17. It was 14th in points. There's the number 37 hobbling around the track. In trouble is Jeremy Mayfield. Waltrip pulling away. There's Mayfield. Oh, what an unfortunate moment.
And Dale Earnhardt.
There's Earnhardt's car in this mess.
Wow, what a tough break for every one of those drivers. Their hopes were so high coming into this race. And here's Todd Bodine already in the pits getting a tire change. There's the car number 37, Jeremy Mayfield. Walter trying to get his car back to the pits, and Earnhardt's apparently won't fire.
Going down a lap. Came in here 15th in the points.
And Kyle Petty. Dick Bergeron mentioned that he was the fastest one in practice here yesterday. Now he's big problems with his Pontiac.
Take a look again as Bobby Hamilton also pits. Here's where it happened, going into turn one, first lap.
Well, right up in this area is where it started. Some contact made with Darrell Waltrip. It looked like the car number 30, Johnny Benson, got into him, buddy.
Exactly what happened. And once it started, it was a chain reaction, and these guys here, they're along for the ride. No way to miss it.
Watch it again.
Okay, let's watch in this area right here. There you see the contact between the yellow car, the number 30 of Johnny Benson, and Darrell Waltrip in the chrome car, number 17. And there's Earnhardt spinning. He's down on the inside spinning down next to the wall, and other cars back here getting involved as well. As Buddy said, it's a chain reaction type of a deal. Once it starts happening in the middle of the pack, everybody's so close together.
Ride with Todd Bodine into this melee. looked like Earnhardt, or rather Waltrip, was trying to get down, couldn't get in, and that's the result. Whoa. He got through it, and just by the hair of his chinny chin chin. You see the 9 car pulling onto pit road now, Lake Speed's car.
Mike Skinner is involved. He has a lot of problems on the back of his car.
Mike?
Waiting on Dale Earnhardt to come in. Bobby Hamilton's been in. Ken, and he has heavy damage on the left rear of his car. The spoiler wasn't bent back too bad, and Robbie Loomis thinks they can get new tires on it, clear the fenders, and it'll be okay. Here comes the Goodwrench Chevrolet. What a dismal season they've had. The left side of Earnhardt's car looks fine. Going to replace the right side tires, and look at the nose. Right on the hood, he got into the back of somebody. That will create an aerodynamic disturbance. It should not affect the car too badly. Now, just to their left, here's Bobby Hamilton back in, and you see the damage on Hamilton's car is to the left side and the left rear. The way that nose has been up is not going to help him today.
Certainly the speeds they run here at the Texas Motor Speedway, aerodynamics are very important. You get those dents and...
Let's review again, however, Ned, the whole story of this preparation for this event. We had 2 days of rain. There wasn't that much time to practice. There was no qualifying. We'll go to Dick Bergeron for a moment for this update and then get back to the story of how this may have come about. Dick?
Well, Kyle Petty's car is in the garage. It's up on jack stands. His wife, Patty, has just been by to console him. Kyle, what happened out there?
I don't know. Bunch of the world's greatest drivers got together for a little mishap down there and won, so that's all I know.
Now, his car is really bent up, Ken. This was the fastest car on the racetrack yesterday, but the whole nose is pushed in on it, and they are in deep trouble today.
The point being on these 24-degree banks. For the most part, they've run that bottom line. We saw the move up, as Buddy Baker pointed out in his opening, an additional 5 feet, but they haven't had that much running on the outside. They're all trying to get to the bottom of the track, and there wasn't room. Back in a moment. In the stampede to turn one on the very first lap, big wreck here at the Texas Motor Speedway. In the pre-race, they had fireworks to introduce the drivers, and then as they introduced the race itself, big fireworks down here. Take a look at what happened again.
Big fireworks going into turn one. As they came across the start-finish line, watch this silver car on the outside. That's Darrell Waltrip. The black car is Dale Earnhardt, and we're gonna freeze it right here. See, those cars make contact right there, just barely, not much. Now we'll move the tape on forward, and we'll see what happens, buddy.
Well, you can see Darrell giving a little bit of room. He gets on the high side of the racetrack, and he says, I don't want to be out here. I need to get back in traffic. He did not see Johnny Benson on the inside. He tries to get back on the bottom part of the racetrack, contact, and watch the cars behind him.
See, Earnhardt gets into the back of the 30 car, and then... Is that Bill Elliott's car that gets involved there as well? The car number 43 right there is Bobby Hamilton.
Yep.
He gets banged up.
Morgan Shepherd in the one.
And yeah, Morgan got the one car. Twice. Hit him the first time. Hit the Hamilton car. He had no place to go. Then after he spun, tagged him again. Gordon, Brett Bodine, Skinner, Todd Bodine, Kyle Petty, Lake Speed, Jimmy Spencer, Earnhardt, all. And Hunt Strickland got a piece of that one, too. Working on Jeremy Mayfield's car. Let's go down to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, thanks, Ken. Darrell is overlooking the work here on the Parts America car. According to Ned and Buddy upstairs, they seem to think it started between you and Earnhardt. What do you think?
No, Benson. Actually, Benson's the one. I got down in there and I had an opening there. Benson looked like he didn't get a good start or something. And I was going to fall in front of Dale. We kind of talked about it. But they didn't go very good, so I went on down. I got to the first turn, a great opportunity to drop to the inside in front of Benson as I started in, and I was in the groove. I don't know if he went on the apron or what he did, but I'm pretty sure he's the one that turned me around. At least I think he was. I got yellow paint on my car, so I'd say he probably was.
Darrell Waltrip will watch them as they try to get his car back in. Let's check with Dick Bergeron.
Well, they're sawing apart the once finely crafted nose of Robbie Gordon's car. This thing doesn't even have a radiator bracket left in it. It is really beaten up. Robbie's standing behind the car, looking at what they're doing. What happened out there?
To be honest with you, that's one of the bad things about no qualifying here. I mean, we started 29th, and I think around row five, I think I saw Darrell spinning first, the first car I saw sideways on the track. And I thought I was clear of it. I was down the bottom, and then out of nowhere, the 43 car came down. which was Bobby Hamilton. I ran right in the side of him. No place for me to go.
Can sure see the disappointment in his face. To Mike Joy.
Nick, there's a logistic issue here in the Earnhardt pit. If he is a lap down, if he had been lapped in the pits, starter Doyle Ford would call for a down figure restart, which would be single file. Earnhardt and his crew are arguing to the NASCAR officials that they got lapped on the racetrack, which means that he would be able to pull up next to the leader on the restart on the inside lane where the lapped cars go. But if he'd been lapped in the pits, he'd have to be at the tail end of the line because on-track lapping had not begun. So that conversation is going on between here and the control tower.
We'll update you on that as soon as we can give you any information from NASCAR. See Skinner back on pit road another time. Take a look from Todd Bodine another time. Back with you again as you follow through with Todd Bodine in this first turn, first lap altercation.
There was a lesson to be learned just then. You could see Bill Elliott keep his race car straight through that wreck instead of locking the brakes up and getting sideways and making his car much bigger.
And Todd Bodine did a great job also. He backed off and kept his race car straight.
The leader continues to be under caution. Lengthy one here. Dale Jarrett in first with Gordon right behind him in that second spot, followed by Terry Labonte. When they come by this time, there'll be one lap until they turn them loose, and we have run the first 10 laps of the Interstate Batteries 500 after trouble in turn one of the first lap with a caution flag out. Take a look at those that were involved here, Ned.
Of course, Morgan Shepherd, Dale Earnhardt, Lake Speed, Brett Bodine. You can see him. You can see a lot of the cars right there on that picture that were involved in it. Darrell Waltrip, Todd Bodine, Mike Skinner. Some of them were not heavily involved. Kyle Petty was. Johnny Benson, Robbie Gordon, Jeremy Mayfield, Bobby Hamilton. He's the 43 car spun sideways there, and Rick Mast. Now, many of those cars have been on pit road, and for the fans that might be watching a NASCAR race for the first time, they can work on those cars and come in, they work on them, wait, work as long as they can before the pace car comes around, get back out. So many of them have stayed in the lead lap.
Let's go back to Ralph Shaheen for a moment.
Again, we've caught up with Jeremy Mayfield, who's watching them work on his car. Jeremy, what took place out there from your view?
I'm not sure. I know some stuff happened in front of us, and I just seen the 43 spinning in the 17, and got caught right in the middle of it. This traffic jam, you know, this place is tight, and I think everybody knew it was going to be tight going into one when they threw the green. And I think everybody's pretty cautious other than that, you know, just it don't take much here when you get out of shape and gathered up a lot of cars.
Obviously, your crew's trying to get you back out. Now, we've heard so much about how difficult it is to pass here. You need to get back out and gain points. How tough is it going to be when you come around this racetrack with guys racing to win and you trying to get around for points?
Well, I think you just got to, when you see them coming, just ride around the apron now. It's going to make for a long day for myself and Darrell and a lot of these other guys. And, you know, what a way for a first time being here, you know, but just make for a long day for us.
Ken, a trickier racetrack might just have gotten more difficult.
Going to 11 laps complete as they take green once again, and seven cars pitted too early. So they're on the tail end of this thing. Among them, Bobby Hamilton's car, and I believe the 25 also was in that penalty.
And when you say pitted too early, NASCAR has an official stationed at the entrance of pit road, and he has a flag that either that the pit roads are closed or they're open, and apparently the pit road was not open when some of them pitted. Mike Joy.
Well, Larry McReynolds has lost the appeal. Rich Bergdorf, the NASCAR official, called it upstairs, but NASCAR said, no, Earnhardt, you're lapped, you start in the back. And so he's got a lot of ground to make up.
Dale Earnhardt caught in that altercation, spun into the inside wall. Here you see the front three. Dale Jarrett in the 88. He's in front and trying to extend that car a couple of car lengths in his back straightaway at over 190 miles per hour. Jeff Gordon tucks right in second spot. And Texas Terry is there knocking on the door.
And here comes Gordon. He's wanting to lead. He moves down on the inside, coming off of turn four. He has a run on him.
Got him. Right through the double dogleg.
Now, most people would say, why did he want to take the lead right away? He knows the track's a little slick. Five bonus points. Those things really make a difference near the end of the year when you're running for the points championship.
As
So Jeff Gordon out in front. And here's Dale Jarrett slipping back into fourth spot. And look who's on the move. It's Jeff Burton, the youngster from Virginia in number 99, who gets stronger with every race, knocking on the door of one of those Roush cars. The 99 into third place.
I think Dale Jarrett must have a little bit of a handling problem right now. He decided to get out of the pressure cooker, drop back, and just ride out till he has a chance to adjust on his car.
Car looks like it's pushing up a little bit coming off the turns, Betty.
Ricky Rudd in the number 10, working on Jeff Bodine in the number 7. Now you're riding with Burton up in third spot. Coming by to complete 15 laps this time. Look at Jeff Bodine fending off Ricky Rudd.
Five Fords running in a row there.
See Wallace in the number 2 there on the tail end of that group. Here comes Rudd down to the inside another time after Bodine in the number 7.
Back
down to the inside comes Ernie Irvin. Blazing away in turn 3. Here he comes barreling through number 4. Ernie Irvin on a roll, pulls up on Rudd.
No feathers on that 28. I'll tell you, Ernie Irvin drives every lap like it's the last one.
Look at Rudd outside.
Ricky Rudd making a move, going down into turn number 1. They say you can't go there. He just did it.
Well, as they came off of turn 4, he and Jeff Bodine got together just a little bit. It killed Bodine's momentum. He had to back off momentarily. It gave Rudd a run. He just motored on by on the outside.
So Ricky Rudd in number 10 on the move is up to 7th spot. And here comes Ernie Irvin after Bodine. Talk about quick. Mile and a half. This is something.
Ernie Irvin's giving a look on the inside as they start down into turn 1. He's working him on both sides right now, trying to get him to look in the mirror, maybe get offline.
Big wreck up in turn number 1. We've got 3 cars in the wall. The 77, Bobby Hillen sliding down the track. Looks like Derek Cope may be involved in it as well. And perhaps that's Greg Sachs. There is the number 77, one of the Texans in the race. Bobby Hillen won that race at Talladega years ago. Having trouble here today, getting collected again. It's turn number 1, which is turning into the Wreck'em Alley of this racetrack. Bobby Hillen.
His car is pretty well banged up. You can see a lot of damage to the rear of his car.
Ned, he's hung up on the bank. If you'll notice, the front of the car is stuck on the bank there, and the back of the car is down on the flat part, and that car is hung up. It will not move right now.
No traction for the wheel here, because of the fact that front of his car is on that bank and the back end touching back here, so he has no traction.
The back of the car is about in the back seat of that number 77. Tail end, look again, watch the bottom of the screen. Oh, they got it going into turn 1. There's that 36 sliding away, Derek Cope. Oh, that's bad news for Derek Cope. That team's been coming along. And here you see that 77 banking up to that 8-degree banking where they would run the Indy-type cars. And there's Greg Sachs, number 20.
Tremendous amount of damage to Greg Sachs' car. This is Derek Cope coming in there. You can see the tires are rubbing quite hard on that car, so they'll have to do a lot of body work to get these cars back into the race.
Meanwhile, Elliott, Skinner, Hamilton all elect to pit another time as we see Greg Sachs pull on pit road.
A lot of damage to his Ford. Let's go to the pits and Dick Berger.
The grill is all pushed in on Bill Elliott's car. It is causing the engine to run hot, so they've lifted the bent-up hood. They're trying to readjust the tin work on the front end of his car. 3 different crew members, including Mike Beam, the crew chief, he's the guy in black, are working on the front end to try to get some more air through the radiator. What a tough day so far in Texas.
I can add to that. That's a box where the air goes back towards the radiator, and once you take a lick in the nose of the race car, it bends that inner works in there, and the air does not flow through the radiator like it would if it was an open box going back towards the radiator.
So lots of cars having lots of problems here early in the race as they try to get Bobby Hillen's car off the banking. Bill Elliott goes back out.
Jeff Gordon now in first spot in this event. We're back under caution for the second time. Big surprise, these cautions coming fast and furious in the early going of the Interstate Batteries 500.
under caution, and that's been the big story thus far. Most of the laps run have been under caution today. As you see, Todd Bodine back here in 25th position with the back end all chewed up on that car. And take a look at what happened. Here's Todd trying to get through. Go to Ralph Shaheen with one of the victims of that three-car altercation.
Well, Derek Hope has climbed out of the Skittles Pontiac. Derek, what happened?
Well, you know, we just kind of evaded that first incident, and then the second time here, we were just running with a bunch of cars there, and, you know, my car was real good. The Skittles Pontiac was real good, and people kept slowing down, getting in the corner there, you know, and just kind of run up on them, and they all checked up in front of us really bad that one time there, and I got in the back of Bobby Hill, and I think Sachs or somebody got in the back of me and spun us around, but, you know, it's just when a car is deficient in one area, it's real difficult. It kind of starts a chain reaction going in these corners.
Does this have something to do with the track or people being too cautious or too aggressive?
Well, like I said, the racetrack, the way it is right now, I mean, it's just that, you know, there's one lane, you got to run the bottom, and if one car that's in a group, you know, is not quite up to speed or he's deficient in one area, can't get in the corner or whatever, as this case here, it slows the whole everybody down, and then kind of a chain reaction, the last two guys in line get the brunt of it.
Derek Cope is okay. The Skittles Pontiac, however, is not. Dick Bergeron?
To my knowledge, the only injury we have seen so far today has been to a crewman. Mike Beam in black, working on Bill Elliott's car, was right at the front of the radiator when the radiator burped and sprayed his left leg with very hot water. Beam, however, although he's limping, he is still in duty. They sprayed a little bit of ice water on him. He is still out there shaking his head now. Tough day for the McDonald's bunch. To Mike Joy.
NASCAR agreed with Larry McReynolds' contention that Dale Earnhardt got lapped on the racetrack. That's not why they restarted him on the back. Larry, what was the call?
You know, I'm not real sure what the call was. What they're saying is when you go a lap down, you can't pit the first time.
And you have to get picked up by the pace car and follow him around?
We never have heard that one. That was a new one on me. But, you know, we're back up the front. We got a chance to make our lap up. I'm a little afraid the front end damage has got us a little too pushy, but we just have to see what happens.
That big dent in the nose has caused Earnhardt to complain the car is a little bit tight in the corner coming off the turn, and that'll make it tough to keep the throttle down. Ken?
Earnhardt in 34th position at the present time, one lap down. And there you see the 77 coming in, and its day is done. Bobby Hillen unable to continue. That's the eighth. Did not finish for Hillen in the last nine races for this Texas driver. Bad break. Back end missing on that machine. Here's Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Greg Sachs is one of the other drivers adding to this growing list of cars parked back here. Greg, what's your view of what happened in that last incident?
Well, it was a tough break for the Hardys Ford. I was entering turn one pretty hard, looking to go to the outside of the Skittles car, and I guess the 77 up in front of him lost it, and all I could do was lock it down and slide into him.
How bad is your car? You look like you're about ready to go.
Well, actually, the chassis is in good shape. We've got to replace a radiator and try to get the sheet metal back in shape. Otherwise, the car's okay.
Headed up to 29 laps, and 16 of them have been run under caution thus far. Here you see Earnhardt pulling up on the inside, racing to get his lap back. He'll be going from the 30. I had him in 34th, now in 35th position. Elliott is in 34th, just on the tail end of the lead lap. But up here trying to get his lap back will be Earnhardt on the restart. And let's set the field for you with Jeff Gordon out in front, the number 24, followed by Terry Labonte, number 5 in second, number 99 in third, and there's Dale Jarrett in fourth, the 88, followed by Mark Martin. There you see Jarrett. And here is Mark Martin in the 6th. He'll be in the 5th position. Right after him comes Bobby Labonte in the 6th spot.
And in 7th place is Ricky Rudd in the car number 10. That car is easy to pick out. And then comes Jeff Bodine in car number 7.
He'll be in 8th. Ernie Irvin should be along in 9th here, Ned.
We saw him pick up a spot there a little bit earlier, passing Rusty Wallace.
And completing the top 10 will be Rusty Wallace in that 10th position. There you see him. Number 2 is Rusty Wallace. And leading the second group is Ted Musgrave. He'll be in 11th spot. Musgrave in the 16, who had that tremendous finish at Darlington, coming home in 2nd place. Pace car is coming in. And as we come around to complete 25 laps this time, they're ready to go back under green.
Well, Jeff Gordon got a great jump there. Earnhardt was not able to make the move on the inside trying to get back in the lead lap because Jeff Gordon knows the outside of the racetrack is nowhere to be right now.
working lap 26 at the present time with Gordon out in front.
Earnhardt is trying hard, though. He's moving up on the back bumper of Jeff Gordon going into turn three. He would like to move up there, try to get right on his back bumper, make the back end of that car a little bit loose so he could maybe move around.
Ooh.
Morgan Shepherd there. Morgan had moved up on the inside trying to get one of his laps back.
Ned, he's just trying to hold that number one on the racetrack. You can see a lot of damage on the front of the car. Aerodynamics plays a big part when you run 197 miles an hour down the straightaway.
And he moved up almost right into the fence that time.
Yeah, he saw once he got up there, he was hoping the car would handle well enough that he might have a chance of getting up there and getting a lap back. He's many laps down. In fact, the scoring is showing that Morgan is eight laps down, but right now he said, I better settle back in here somewhere.
37th position. You see Kenny Schrader in the 33 scooting by to see him have a good run today. You're back with Jeff Gordon out in front. The number 24 car storming up through the field. Jeff Gordon says there's nothing like confidence. Ah, take a look at this. As the 28 car zooms past, and here comes Rusty Wallace as well.
On the outside. Wow.
Ned, they kind of worked this groove over getting in the corner yesterday on that second. They're actually in the bottom lane, but they move up about a half a car width over, and they have room enough to pass on the high side.
Well, certainly that was an indication of give and take. Jeff Bodine had to give some there for them to be able to take those positions.
Ernie Irvin, number 28, moved to eighth position. Rusty Wallace, number two, into ninth. And Jeff Bodine was relegated back to the 10th spot. Just behind Bodine is Musgrave.
There's a suspension cam on Rusty Wallace's suspension. As you see it work up and down, the part of the steering mechanism right here.
The one thing you can notice is the brake rotors were not glowing. They're not using the brakes here. They're pretty well wide open. You can see going in the corner here that this wheel is not lighting up. On the short tracks, that would be all red, that
area right here.
Yeah. Oh, he just touched it right there. You can see just fading into the corner. He touched the brake a little bit.
Rusty Wallace, number two, ninth position. Jeff Gordon in front. Started to say there's nothing like confidence, says Gordon. Believing in your own mind you can do something. We believe in our minds that we can go to every racetrack and do well, be a factor. And he's a factor in the early going today. He has Earnhardt a lap down. Look at Musgrave working on Bodine here. The number seven car is in 10th spot. Musgrave coming along, and with him, good run today for Ward Burton in the 22.
Ward Burton in the 22. He's had a pretty disastrous year as far as the way the car's run all year long. He had a real serious run at Daytona, got up in the top five. But other than that, you can see right now, he wants to make his point right now. This car is really handling well. The 22, the black car, is making a move.
Ralph Shaheen.
Ken Squire, when you have a heavy accident like these drivers have just had, you might think it would take days to get the cars back out on the racetrack. Not such here with Winston Cup Racing. They have these war wagons all set to go with everything you need. They can rebuild either the front or the back end of the car. They've got generators, welding equipment, air guns, and the most important, zip ties. What would take you and I to suffer through a wreck like this, maybe weeks at a body shop, will take these competitors just a handful of laps.
At yellow number 30, scooting up on the outside, trying to make a run. Now we're back again with that number seven. And where's Musgrave in this picture for the moment? Remember, he was right there.
He's in another area code. He passed and went on just a second ago. You see Ward Burton really working on the back of Bodine. I think Bodine right now needs to adjust on the chassis of that car. With the limited amount of practice that they had this week, I'm sure the first pit stop is going to really mean something.
And here's Sterling Marlin. He's been passing cars and coming up through there. The two-time Daytona 500 winner is moving on up towards the front.
14th position now for Marlin. Musgrave has tripped up into 10th. Bodine back to 11th. Ward Burton. You see him in that number 22 in 12th. Followed by the 21 of Michael Waltrip in the 13th spot. Last lap at 179.8. 179.8. What kind of miles per hour will get this thing done if they don't get back under caution?
You can see that Ward Burton in the 22 now has a real good run down the back straightaway. I think Jeff, you see Jeff just back out and let him go. Michael Waltrip goes by, Sterling Marlin comes by. That's what happens. You just have to give and take on this racetrack. Ooh. Speaking of which,
That was John Andretti in the white and red number 98 and Steve Grissom in the white number 41 Chevrolet coming by Jeff Bodine. Jeff's car is not handling too well and he's doing the right thing, not forcing the issue, staying there and just hanging on until he can get a pit stop and make some adjustments on his car.
Andretti was giving, Bodine was taking on that one. Here's the 41 Grissom, who had that horrendous wreck at Atlanta earlier this year. A 190 mile per hour slide into the wall backwards that tore the car in two. Back and looking good today is Grissom in that number 41. He's up in 15th. Here's the man in front, Gordon, leading the way. 23 of 36 laps, and a lot of them under caution. See some of the interval there. He continues to punch it through.
He's pulling away.
Well, you heard Ray Evernham say we did a lot to make this car really turn well in the center part of the corner. They loosened it up real well, and it seems right now they guessed right.
Big time right. Front of the field. Up, look at Elliott scooting down to the bottom. And that number 94, he's fighting his way out of the back of the pack and coming along very nicely. Moving up into the top.
What, just took over
25.
The
25. Where is he now?
Well, scoring was showing him in 31st position 31st. When he went around. Kenny Schrader.
I was watching when he was in the pits. They took some of that ductwork out that was making him run hot and threw it over the inside wall there, and it seems the car is really working pretty well for Bill Elliott.
Schrader had backed up. He had been running in 25th in that last couple of laps. He went well back in the field. Not sure what the story is on Ken Schrader with Mark Martin now in the number six car. Fifth place. Just in front of him, Dale Jarrett.
Mark's up there working on Jarrett. He wants that position. Jarrett won't fight him. He'll let him go by. Here he comes, down on the inside.
See you later, Mark.
Mark has more laps on this racetrack than any other driver because of all the tire testing he did here. And then, of course, running in the 300-miler yesterday and winning. Good experience for him.
When you see a driver move over like that, what that means later on in the race, if Dale Jarrett's running a little bit better than Mark Martin, they'll return that favor. You get nothing for being pig-headed out here.
Cole Sitter, Dale Jarrett just sliding back. Right now the team cars, the Hendrick cars, are in first and second spot with Jeff Gordon and Terry Labonte. You have the Roush cars. They're in the third and fourth position with Burton and Martin. And then Yates Racing, they're back there in the fifth and
sixth.
Sixth, yeah.
Urban running in sixth place.
How would you like to have a mirror like that on your road car? You can see around the whole car. That's a panoramic mirror that they use in race cars, and you can see the left rear quarter, the right rear quarter, and what's directly behind you.
Keep you awful busy looking out back, it would seem. Here's Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, update you on the skull machine of Kenny Schrader. His car is very, very tight right now. They hope to loosen him up at the first pit stop.
He had such a good run that he was moving toward that 20th position, and he did back up in a couple of laps. CBS Sports coverage of the inaugural Interstate Batteries 500 continues after this message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports presentation of the Interstate Batteries 500 is sponsored by Napa Auto Parts. We keep America running. Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. And by Miller Lite, who reminds you that anything can happen at Miller time.
I'd like to thank Blockbuster for providing CBS Sports with these beautiful aerial views of this beautiful new racing facility, Fort Worth, Texas area. Interstate Batteries 500. Here you see Jeff Gordon working some lap traffic, moving around. Mike Wallace up on Billy Stanbridge now.
Mike Wallace in 33rd position.
Let's go to Dick Berggren.
Just had one of those little conversations with Ray Evernham where it's so loud down here you can't talk and you can't be heard. So we did it by hand signals, and Ray basically gestured, the car is fine, no problem. That's no surprise, Gordon's leading. However, we had the same conversation with Todd Parrott. He's crew chief for Dale Jarrett, who had started on the pole, slipped back to fifth now. He says they are just fine too. They're just trying to be as smart as they possibly can. All these guys have seen the accidents here in Texas so far, and they all want to run to the end. So Starting to play it cool, guys.
The Hendrick cars, first, second, and in 22nd. First, second, and 22nd. Gordon Labonte and Todd Bodine. Now take a look here. This is Chad Little in the number 97 with his new colors this year, coming after number 7. That's Bodine for 17th spot. You see, and right with him comes Benson.
I was just fixing to say, Johnny Benson passing on the outside. He was involved in that first wreck, but you can see they have the car going back at full steam.
And Hut Strickland in the number 8, giving the Stavola brothers a good ride as we're still in the early going here today. Hut Strickland moving along up here, Ned. 20th position for him. And here's Kyle Petty with a Saturday night special, this number 44.
Wow. I'm telling you, that looks like something that'd run over here at the Devil's Bowl about 30 miles from here.
Well, of course, the NASCAR officials have been in there and watched the work that was going on Kyle's car as he comes into the pits there right now for maybe some other adjustments. But they know that he can't run up to full speed out there, so they will let it run as long as all of the main safety parts are on the car.
Exactly right. You can see all the main bars and everything are intact, so they'll let him run it, but he has to maintain a certain speed to stay out on the racetrack.
Well, they've cleaned it up. They've cut it off, so there's nothing loose falling off the thing, and he sure is running for points. Kyle Petty, who was the fastest in the happy hour last night, unofficially, he was the quickest thing here. Bad break for Kyle Petty and that Petty team. Now here you see Chad Little trying to hold off Johnny Benson now in that 17th and 18th position. Strickland in there as well. Meanwhile, got a challenge up here as they get a little closer. Ernie Irvin is moving in another time on the 88 of Dale Jarrett, the two-time winner this year.
Ran up on some lap traffic. That was Mike Wallace, who was lapped a little bit earlier by Jeff Gordon. And Billy Standridge also went a lap down.
Ned, you could see a difference in the way they're driving the racetrack. You could watch the 88 of Dale Jarrett very low on the groove, and Ernie Irvin kind of diamond in the corner. You see him going up right there off the white line just a little bit. Turn one, and then when they come off down, look at this. Look at this.
Bobby Labonte's net giving him fits right now.
Boy, that window net is, that's not the way it's supposed to be.
Like he's got a nor'easter out there.
Sounds like a flag on my deck out there at Lake Norman at home.
That's seventh place.
Well, they'll have pit stops coming up in the next 15 laps. And so he's hoping that he can go till then and maybe get that thing tightened up a little bit.
Got to be a little distracting at 190 miles an hour, peeling off into turn number one.
That's a new paint job just for this race on the Bobby Labonte car. You can see the big star of Texas on the front of it there.
One of the Corpus Christi Comets out here today. And he's sure flashing those colors. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Ken, one of the advantages of having a two or more car team is that you can trade information between drivers. Mark Martin in third place, teammate Jeff Burton in fourth, both those cars owned by Jack Roush. Mark said the groove he was working yesterday has seemed to come in. That part of the racetrack works pretty well. Jeff Burton went up there and tried it and found that his car up there was a little bit tight. His crew chief, Buddy Parrott, will change that with an air pressure adjustment when they pit about lap 70. But there's a good bit of horse trading going on here about strategies and where on the racetrack is the best place to run.
Elliott, the 30th place car, has just been lapped by the leader, Jeff Gordon.
Well, you can see Terry Labonte moving right on the deck lid of Jeff Gordon as they start around here. Terry Labonte does not have those 5 points yet, so he's trying to get by Jeff Gordon to pick up 5 bonus points for leading the lap here in Texas.
Dave Marcus, 29th place car, number 71, bottom of the racetrack. As a guy who had never driven a stock car until 1990. Boy, has he got used to it in a hurry. Jeff Gordon continues to lead here. Went down to the Buck Baker School in Rockingham June of that year and driving everything else, midgets, sprints, go-karts. And he put it together and here he goes.
Buddy might have helped to train him a little bit, didn't
he? Well, I'll tell you one thing. He called his mom the first night after the first day of the class and said, Mom, I found out what I want to do the rest of my life.
They say he was up to speed almost immediately, and he sure is today. We'll take a break and be back for more of the action. We're now showing 57 laps complete.
This CBS Sports Race Summary is sponsored by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car.
After 61 laps, 91 and a half miles, we've had 2 leaders, 1 lead change, and that average speed way down, that Jared, 108 cautions, big ones, 17 laps.
Yeah, the caution laps have reduced the overall average speed, but they're running laps out on the racetrack of well up in the 170-mile-an-hour range.
There are the cars that have officially retired from the event. Robbie Gordon, DW, he might get back, but for the moment, he's KO'd. Mayfield, Cope, Sachs, Hillen crashed out of this event. Meanwhile, up in front, you have Jeff Gordon in the lead, and the defending Winston Cup champion, Texas, Terry Labonte, bearing down in number 5.
Ernie Irvin about to come into the pits, the first of the front runners coming in. This should be a scheduled pit stop.
Yates car is scheduled to come in the next 2 laps. First one in is Ernie Irvin. Now, what about this rear spoiler at 5 1/4 inches, Buddy Baker?
Well, it looks like the Chevrolets right now have a little upper hand, but Mark Martin sitting there in third, running a very, very competitive race.
Dick Bergeron.
This was a planned pit stop, Ken. They have a board here, and they keep track of every single lap and how many caution laps there were, and they had lap 64 on that board for a long time. Wow, Joey Knuckles flying around the front of that car. He's your front tire changer. It's going to be a 4-tire change, a couple cans of gas, not a lot of big adjustments. Only problem, pushing off the corner. Knuckles shows him which way to go.
19 and a half seconds, and now number 88. Here's Dale Jarrett, who sat on the pole, coming in. And also coming in is Rusty Wallace. Here's Dick Bergeron.
Jarrett is pitting right in front of his teammate Irvin. He just waited one more lap to make his pit stops, and this ought to start everybody coming in. Rusty Wallace just went by for his stop, and this will also set the tone of what they will do. So far, everybody has taken 4 tires, 2 cans of gas, careful, careful stops so they don't mess anything up, and Jarrett is gone.
Pit stops the order of the day. Grissom is now in. Brett Bodine on pit road.
Michael Waltrip coming down pit road. Also the car number 98, John Andretti. Steve Grissom going out of the pits.
Michael Waltrip had been in that 12th position. Here's Ralph Shaheen.
Well, the Tony Freer-led crew of John Andretti's car is going to work on his machine. They're going to take out a little bit of the wedge to loosen him up just a hair. They feel really good about this car right now. He's got this Ford running up in 12th position. As soon as they get the tires changed on the left side, they're going to get him back out of the race course. They're feeling really good about this car and its potential. Ken?
All right, here's number 5, into the lead, getting those 5 points. As we get down toward time to pit these cars, you have Terry Labonte taking the lead from his teammate.
Are the Chevrolets getting that much better gas mileage than the Fords? Most of the Fords have been in. Jeff Bodine comes in right now, Ken Schrader, and Joe Nemechek coming into the pits.
5.5 to 6 miles per gallon on these cars, turning out some 740, 750 horsepower. And those 2 leaders are staying out there. Does and look like they...
No, Jeff Gordon comes
Jeff
in
Gordon
right now.
After we speak.
I thought they were supposed to come in at turn 3 down to the bottom. Sure wasn't there.
They had that rule for the Busch cars yesterday, but I don't think that's the rule for the Winston Cup cars today. Let's go to the pits and Dick Bergeron.
Ken, in the drivers' meeting, they said they didn't want to do it. A lot of the drivers complained and said they wanted to do it, but NASCAR said, no, we're going to make these regular pit stops. And right now, Jeff Gordon is taking a regular pit stop. The most important thing about these pit stops this early on in the game, don't make a mistake. Don't put your driver behind, because pit stops are so very important. You can't lose anything. But the right rear guy, Chad Knaus, just fell going around Gordon's car and is going to slow his pit stop down, and he is one disappointed number guy. 22.1 to Mike Joy.
A 4-tire change for Dale Earnhardt. Won't be able to make up this lap under this green flag run. Jimmy Elledge and Mark Armstrong hammer the lug nuts home, and Earnhardt, with a 1-pound air pressure reduction on the right side tires, is back out on the race.
Changing that tire pressure, one of the keys here in this mile and a half.
Well, you asked me a question just a while ago about the 6 car of Mark Martin, the Ford. He's still out there and has led a lap now. Picked up those valuable points.
Coming in right now, buddy. Yeah, he stayed out there to lead that lap. Picked up that 5 bonus points, and he comes into the pits now.
And you see Terry Labonte coming out in the 21 car. Michael Waltrip has been assessed a stop-and-go penalty. He was too fast on pit road. That's going to hurt the Wood Brothers as we watch Mark Martin wheel to a stop here. And we're seeing Ernie Irvin come back in for a second stop on number 28. He was in four laps ago.
Yes, he was.
There's Michael Waltrip back on the track. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Four tire change for Mark Martin. Butch Hilton and Ben Leslie changing tires. Lonnie Dubé pouring the gas in. Mark winds it up and takes off.
So he's back underway. Ernie Irvin, looks like they may have had a tire that was out of kilter there, and they've come back in and changed a right rear, I think, and gone back out. Here's the 18 of Bobby Labonte on pit road as Ernie Irvin comes in after a second stop in one of the Robert Yates cars.
Bobby Labonte stayed out there and led a lap, got those five bonus points that Buddy has been talking about as Jimmy Maycar and his crew go to work on that car to change all four tires, perhaps make an adjustment.
Bobby Labonte came in leading the event with Mike Skinner in second. We're in this period of green flag stops as you ride with Bobby Labonte back out onto the track, down here into turn number one, down in this 8-degree banking, and ready to move out of the track.
Well, you see him staying down out of the groove. It's against the rules to go onto the racing surface until you get on the back straightaway.
Mike Skinner, Earnhardt's teammate, bruised and battered, number 31, is now the leader in the Interstate Batteries 500.
And he had stopped during one of the other cautions, Ken, so he can stay out there a while. He has enough fuel to stay out there a while.
And he's got that rear spoiler on that car up in the air, believe you me.
And there are a number of drivers who had made pit stops during the other cautions that will be off sequence as far as the leaders are concerned. And so they'll stay out there a while and get their time in the limelight.
Leading in the rookie points, Mike Skinner, no rookie this guy as far as racing is concerned, dominated that Craftsman Truck Series of NASCAR, of which we're pleased to bring you a lot of events this summer here on CBS. Here's Dick Berggren.
Ernie Irvin made a costly second pit stop. They weren't exactly sure what was wrong. He said he thought a tire was the problem. They changed the tires. Nothing visibly wrong with the tires, but with a new right front on the car, Ernie Irvin said it's fine now. But he didn't need to make that extra pit stop in terms of track position, Ken.
4.5 seconds, the interval between first place, Skinner, and Bill Elliott. Now in second with Dave Marcus in third. They're out of kilter with the front of the field on these green flag pit stops. Beginning Thursday, CBS Sports presents a tradition unlike any other, the Masters. Highlights begin after your late local news on Thursday and Friday, then full coverage begins Saturday at 3:30 Eastern. And final round coverage Sunday at 4 o'clock Eastern. The Masters on CBS Sports. Mike Skinner, whose motto is win, crash, or blow, out in front in this Interstate Batteries 500. Here's Mike Joy.
Can't everyone expected Rusty Wallace to be a contender here today, but he developed a very bad push, the car wanting to go straight and not turn left. They came in and made a four-tire change, and they added two rounds of wedge in the right rear of the car to try to pick up the handling a bit. It was not a slow pit stop, 19.2 seconds, but the time Wallace lost on the track when he couldn't apply full throttle coming off the corner has really hurt him.
There you see Wallace is trying to get back in that lead lap.
In fact, it just passed Mike Skinner a couple of laps ago, Ken, and did indeed get back in the lead lap. Now, remember, Mike Skinner's got a pit stop coming up here before too long. Jeff Gordon has moved into second place now. He just passed Terry Labonte here a few laps ago. So he is in second place with Mike Skinner, who is leading this race as a result of pitting earlier under caution and staying out there right now. Good strategy.
That's Bobby Labonte in that seventh position. We're riding with him as he tries to get around Todd Bodine, who's been having his problems and is back in 24th. Now here's Mike Skinner. Slowing, coming on the pit road, 55 mile an hour speed limit on pit road today. The 1995 Craftsman Truck Champion of NASCAR wheels this car of Richard Childress to a stop. Here's Dick Berg.
He's also the guy that set on the pole for the Daytona 500, and he is a guy who has his hands full this afternoon. The back end of that race car was damaged in one of those earlier altercations, and I mean big time damage, to the point that it is trying to lift the back end right off the racetrack. Skinner just radioed his crew and said, "This is an awful shame. We have one great motor under the hood." He is out of the lead now on pit road. Four tires. He's going to go out and try to fight some more.
Well, Dick, he'll go a lap down. In fact, I'm sure some fans are wondering, before the leaders started making their pit stops, Labonte and Gordon and them, we saw them put a lap on Mike Skinner out on the racetrack. And they said, how in the world did he get back in the lead? Well, when they made their pit stop, you lose more than a lap. Till you get slowed down, come in, make your pit stop, get your speed back up. You lose more than a lap on the racetrack. So that's how he made that lap up and got in the lead.
Robbie Gordon.
Jeff Gordon.
Brother Jeff Gordon in the 24. Pulls up on the back of Chad Little, the 97, and he is back into first place as he scoots to the bottom of the track. Chad, you see the 8, Hut Strickland there.
Hut Strickland just went a lap down. He's in 16th position. Chad Little doing a good job in 15th.
Now, that's two different styles there. You see the 97 there of Little. He's not able to hold the car right on the white line through the corner. He's washing up in the middle. Jeff Gordon's car looks flawless.
Jeff Gordon in front, Terry Labonte in second. You saw the 99 a moment ago. Well, he's had to make two pit stops of recent, and all of a sudden, Jeff Burton is well back, 21st position.
He's a lap down.
I'd like to take that back. Jeff Gordon's handling down the straightaway, folks. That thing's flying down the straightaway. He just pulled over on Chad Little, and watch him accelerate off the corner here. That car is a rocket ship once he gets it pointed in the right direction.
Just be careful not to cut down too soon going into this turn. Little still there, and Little backs off. Sometimes it's awfully easy. You go into that corner, you think you got it cleared. Of course, they have spotters that are telling the drivers, okay, you're clear, or not clear, whatever the case might be. There's Terry Labonte in the 5 car. Jeff Gordon in the 24 is leading this race, putting another lap on Bobby Hamilton. His car injured early on the very first lap. There's Terry Labonte. He's in second place on car number 5.
Derek Cope has come out, turned a few more laps, and he's going back to the garage area again, caught up in an incident earlier. He's many, many laps down. We're at 88 of the 300 and 34 laps to be run in this 500-mile race. Here's Ralph Sheheen.
Ken Squire, the car of Jimmy Spencer is a really good machine right now. He's running up in 10th position, but he's having a trouble seeing. They use this 10-foot pole here with the squeegee in the end and some all-purpose cleaner, dip it in water, rub it up the windshield and clean it off. They didn't get a very good job done in the last round of pit stops, and Jimmy is driving blind right now. He's doing a masterful job running it down the pit.
And he's in 10th place, Jimmy Spencer, right now. Second place finisher in the Grand National race to Mark Martin in yesterday's battle, which was a good one here at this brand new mile and a half Texas Motor Speedway.
You know, Ned, I think he has probably developed into a better race car driver this year than anybody as far as improving over a style that used to tear up a lot of race cars. He shows a lot of maturity now.
He certainly does.
You see Earnhardt in that number 3, and he's back in 25th spot still, a lap down after he was caught up in an incident down here in turn number 1. Ernie Irvin pulling alongside as they put a lap on Kyle Petty's mauled number 44. Those hot wheels, they've been beaten up pretty well thus far this afternoon.
And the laps that Jeff Gordon is turning here right now, the speed that he's turning those laps, I should say, he is lapping the field. Only 14 cars left on the lead lap.
Irvin is in 25th spot. Meanwhile, let's take a look at the leaders. It's Jeff Gordon in the number 24. Trying to pull another one out of the fire. This the inaugural race. Remember, he won that first race at Indianapolis in the Brickyard 400. Can he do it here today? Just behind him, Terry Labonte is in second spot. Then it's Jarrett in third, followed by the likes of Mark Martin in fourth. Fifth is Bobby Labonte. Ricky Rudd is in sixth. You've got Ward Burton running in seventh, Musgrave in eighth. Sterling Marlin up to ninth, huh?
Yeah, and Jimmy Spencer running there in 10th place, really taking a good look at the setups on the car. He's doing a great job.
Tell you another big surprise here today, as he was last week when he won at Hickory and had a great race again yesterday. Something went amiss just at the end of the event. But Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin's Dick Trickle in the Juni Donlevy number 90 is now up to 11th place, and look at him go. There he is, Dick Trickle, still gathering in cars, and he's coming up to try to take 10th. This is some run. Here's your race summary. 6 different leaders. Look at number 90, Dick Trickle, working for 10th position. And right with him, there you see Rusty Wallace.
I tell you what I was watching the two of Rusty Wallace in the middle part of the corner. That car is dialed in now. They may have had a pushing problem earlier, but boy, does he get off the corner good.
He's going to have to go, buddy, because Jeff Gordon is not far behind this group of cars who are racing for position, as Rusty Wallace now takes the position from Jimmy Spencer. Here comes Johnny Benson down on the inside as well. They're racing for that 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th position.
94, 95 laps complete this time, 142 and a half miles of the 500 mile races to be run. And here you see that number 23 of Jimmy Spencer being challenged. And that is Todd Bodine in the 25, replacing the injured Ricky Craven today.
Todd Bodine is the last car on the lead lap. He is running in the 14th position, and right on his back bumper is Jeff Gordon, his teammate. So he's about to go a lap down.
Two major crashes in the early going, and here comes that leader trying to put a lap on Todd Bodine. He's going to the inside and sneaking through. They're going to get Spencer here and put him a lap down.
Ooh.
Almost. Oh, turns him around. The leader getting caught by Jimmy Spencer. He goes up into the wall. Caution is out. That's number three today.
What a break for Rusty Wallace, Todd Bodine, Johnny Benson, Dick Trickle. All of those drivers were about to go a lap down. Good break for them, bad break for that guy right there, Jimmy Spencer.
That's what I was just going to say. Jimmy Spencer did not see Jeff Gordon coming up under him there, trying to stay in the lead lap, pulled over and got tagged.
Maybe for Gordon, too.
Well, we wonder how much, if any, damage they might have done to Jeff Gordon's car. They didn't make heavy contact. I think the problem that we see with Jimmy Spencer's car right there was maybe when he backed into the wall down on the inside.
145 and a half miles down. The 97th lap were under caution again today. Two extensive cautions, one right on the first lap in the first turn that ate up a lot of cars. Let's take a look at what happened out here.
As you can see, Todd Bodine in the 25 goes by Spencer going in down into turn one. Here comes Jeff Gordon down on the inside, and as Buddy said, Spencer probably didn't see him, came down onto Jeff Gordon. They touch, and up into the wall goes Spencer.
I can add to that. You can see the 24 of Jeff Gordon go completely under the white line going in the corner, trying to stay off of him. You see his left side is down below there. Spencer come down just enough to get tagged.
And boy, Jeff Gordon did a good job. He was about to run right back into the side of Spencer's car, but he had the brakes on, trying to slow it down as much as possible. Now,
Jeff Gordon. Jimmy Spencer yet to score a top 20 finish this year, and it will not happen at the new Texas Motor Speedway before this sold-out capacity crowd. Dick Bergman.
There does not appear to be any damage to the front end of Jeff Gordon's car despite that contact, Ken. They've changed four tires on it. They've set them off for gas. No apparent damage, they hope.
Well, at that point, part of the racetrack, you don't even have to hardly touch a car. If you could get your fist outside of that car and touch that left rear quarter, when they turn in like that, you could turn that car around. You don't have to hit them very hard at all.
There you see Terry Labonte's number five.
He got out first.
Got out first. So that's going to put him up for the top spot when we resume racing in the Interstate Batteries 500. Stay with us. Next Sunday, 3 o'clock Eastern, get a special look at the life and development of a budding superstar, Tiger Woods, son, hero, champion. Jim Nance narrates with exclusive family movies and interviews with some of the all-time greats like Jack Nicklaus and Arnold Palmer, Byron Nelson. It's going to be a grand show next Sunday at 3 o'clock. There you see some of those 64 suites that are being built off turn number two, and I understand most of them already have names going up. The plates are already in place. Amazing racetrack. Sold out today, all the seats, suites filled, everyone here, and all the traffic was able to get in. Take a look at these pit stops and where they are now.
Jeff Gordon back and forth.
Yeah, they had to check that right front to be sure that everything was okay there, so he dropped from first to fourth. Terry Labonte went from second to first. Dale Jarrett from third to second.
Now, the 25, Todd Bodine, he was too fast on pit road. He's going to have to start at the end of the longest line. He's still in the lead lap, but he's got some work to do. Here's Mike Joy.
Joe Gibbs is here, of course, is Bobby Labonte's car owner, trying to win this race for the title sponsor. And some tough news today that Jack Kent Cook, the owner of the Redskins, for whom you won some Super Bowls, has passed away.
Well, I lost a good friend, and I think we everybody that knew Jack Kent Cook knew that he was a great sportsman. He was a great team owner. He fought for what was best in the league. He fought for number one for the Redskins. He's one of those rare people that was a tough guy, a super smart guy. And for Mr. Cook, he was always better when things were at their worst. He was a tough guy, and you know, I think we all are going to really miss him, particularly the people in Washington. And I just sent him a letter about 3 months ago and told him that I hope we can spend some time in heaven kind of sharing things together in some of those talks. And he assured me that that was going to be the case, and I feel good about that.
So too. Thanks, Joe. Mr. Cook passed away of a heart attack this morning. Kim?
Joe Gibbs, car owner here in Winston Cup Racing, and you know his story with the Washington Redskins. I believe we can talk to the car owner of number 24 here for a moment, Ned. Rick Hendrick, do you hear us here? Rick Hendrick, Buddy Baker, Ned Jarrett, Ken Squire along. Can we get a word from you?
Sir, go ahead.
Well, what do you think of this? You've got your guys back up here running up in front in this race. Here's Gordon in fourth, and you've got your Terry Labonte leading this thing. How do you feel about it, Rick?
Well, it's a great feeling right now, Ken. There's been a bunch of close calls in this race, and it's hard on your heart when you have to sit here and watch it at home.
Well, how do you feel? That's the question for all the racing fans that enjoyed so much your miracle finish down there at Daytona.
Well, we're going through the treatments now and a little weak, but hopefully it won't be too many more months. We'd sure like to get back to the racetrack because we miss seeing all the guys.
As you know, Rick is suffering from cancer and being treated at the present time, chemotherapy.
Rick, this is Buddy Baker. I just want you to know that all of us from CBS and all the race fans around the country are praying for your good health and your return to our sport.
Hey, thanks a lot. All of the cards and letters from the fans, it meant so much. It's the best medicine in the world. We love all you guys and the fans, and hopefully we'll be back there before too long.
Rick, this is Ned Jarrett, and we certainly hope that won't be too long to see you back there. And I know that you are enjoying this race with those Chevrolets of yours running up front there today. Have you seen anything back home there today that we might not be seeing here on television as far as the competition is concerned?
You know, it just looks like you got to be awful careful if you touch each other. It's a big accident. You know, Todd did a good job of getting through the one he was in, and it's just got to be real careful and got to be smart or you're not going to finish this thing.
Okay, thank you very much, Rick Hendrick, and God bless you.
And remember that effort they're making for the National Bone Marrow Drive out here. Terry Labonte gave his entire purse yesterday before the Daytona 500 telecast. They only had about 100 calls a day to that National Bone Marrow Donor Program. They received 14,000 calls because of the televised broadcast and our mention of it at Daytona. And we hope we have more folks that will take advantage of that phone number. We'll show you a little later this afternoon. CBS Sports coverage of the inaugural Interstate Batteries 500 will continue after this message and a word from your local station. The race just back under green at lap 105. 157.5 miles have been completed, and the lineup is Terry Labonte in front, working through lap cars with Dale Jarrett in second. Mark Martin falling back as Jeff Gordon goes to third. Martin in fourth, Musgrave fifth, Bobby Labonte in sixth, Ricky Rudd seventh, Ward Burton eighth, and you have Sterling Marlin in ninth and Rusty Wallace into tenth with Johnny Benson and Dick Trickle rounding out the top 12. And now look at this move.
A lot of drivers up there trying to get their laps back, and Hutch Strickland did get back. He is back in the lead lap there right now. Chad Little trying to get on the inside of Terry Labonte as they come off of turn four, and right behind him is Jeff Burton. They're all one lap down, trying to get back in the lead lap.
Yeah, if they can hold him out there, that preferred line right now is right around the base of the racetrack. You can see Terry Labonte kind of moving back there as they start up through there. The only part is we're having a lead change.
That's right. We're going to have Dale Jarrett come right tearing down through in that same thing. That's not lap traffic. Those go for lead positions. That's the 88, Dale Jarrett, sticking it to Labonte and taking over with Jeff Gordon going to second.
Well, Jarrett took advantage of the situation of those lap cars that had Terry Labonte pinned up on the outside, and Terry Labonte is too smart to try to race up there on that outside right now. That groove is the best down on the inside, so he just backed off once he got up in that position, said, okay, guys, let's get this thing strung out here and sort it out a little bit before we start making any radical moves.
Jeff Gordon looking to the inside on the 88, and at the same time, Ralph Shaheen has found Jimmy Spencer in that last altercation. Ralph?
Keanu has just come out of the Columbia Infield Care Center. Jimmy, what happened out there?
Well, we had the wall, you know. The leader was coming underneath me, and I'm trying to give as much room as I could. Racetrack's terrible. I mean, it's a one-groove racetrack, and the Camel car was running really good. We had a bad deal on the pits. Got the windshield all oily and heck, and I couldn't see. Trying to bide my time. That's no excuse for it. It's our fault. Maybe we'll do better next week.
Yep.
Jeff Burton, one of those lap cars in the 99, tries to scoot down on the bottom, get under Hutch Strickland, and he makes that move.
Yeah, he might be one of those cars. Although Chad Little and Hutch Strickland are doing a good job of staying out there. Chad Little in the green car, right in front of Dale Jarrett, and then Hutch Strickland in the red number 8, and Jeff Burton in the 99 car. Jeff Burton, it might be fast enough to stay out there. Those others might be also, but certainly I think Burton has a better chance of staying out there because he's been fast.
14th, 15th, and 16th. Move back onto the lead lap. Here's Dick Berggren.
Just a moment ago, Ray Everingham put on the radio and talked to his driver, Jeff Gordon. He said, I got a plan. He says, let's do what we did at Daytona. Patiently aggressive. Gordon waited a second, and then he said, sounds good to me. That's the strategy for Jeff Gordon. To Mike Joy.
Ken, that hookup with Rick Hendrick might have sounded like a cell phone call. It was anything but. Rick has every race fan's dream sitting at home there in Charlotte. He can take the in-car radio communication from all three of his cars, plus the talk-around channel, and choose between the four of them like he had a scanner here at the racetrack. And he can talk to all of his drivers and, of course, the CBS. Racing Electronics handles their in-car communications, and they put all this together. The price? You don't want to ask.
Hey, buddy, I want to ask you, does that Dale Jarrett, number 88, look just a little loose there a moment ago? Ooh, watch.
Just off the corner, but the man on the move right now is the 28 of Ernie Irvin. He just got by Jeff Gordon and moved right on by him. He's trying to make up a lap right now. You know, he had a problem a while ago and had to come back in the pits. Now he's really got the hammer down.
Made that extra pit stop, got a lap down, and I think one thing that Dale Jarrett was trying to do was hold off Jeff Gordon long enough for his teammate Ernie Irvin to get up there, and Jarrett probably won't fight Ernie, let him get back in the lead lap in case there is a caution. Then he'd be right back in the thick of this thing.
So you have Irvin back there in 17th position, right behind the 88. One lap down, one position away from going into that lap, as you will hope to get a little close there, working around some of the wreckage that's still flying on the speedway.
Yeah, that brought my left leg up there just then. I'll tell you what, you're getting awful close there, and it's early in the race here, but Ernie Irvin's a lap down, and he has to get back up there.
Well, he's right behind his teammate. The Robert Yates cars are running in first and 17th position. And right now, Irvin is one spot away from getting back in that lead lap.
He's running in the 17th position, one lap down. And while all this is going on here that we're watching on the screen, Jeff Burton, who passed the leaders a little bit ago, absolutely driven away from this pack of cars as Ernie Irvin tried to get by Dale Jarrett. Couldn't quite make it that time.
Ned, you're a special man when you got a son out there, and Ernie Irvin drove right up on that left rear corner going into turn one, and you're talking about other people. I'd have to say something.
Oh, they're good professional race drivers.
Best in the world. I tell you what, they're getting the job done here today at Texas.
Well, Dale Jarrett out in front. He has had a top three finish in the last
12 Winston Cup races. Out of the last 12 races, in 9 of them, he's had a top three finish.
What we're seeing right now is the lap cars now are beginning to give up a little bit. The tires are getting hot and they're starting to move around a little bit. You see Jarrett there being very patient, but sooner or later he's going to have to make a move on the two cars that got back in the lead lap because they're really holding this bunch up. Mark Martin's moved into the fight now. He's sitting there just waiting to make it move towards the front. This is a good tight race. You see Terry Labonte also moving in here.
Interval first to fifth. Less than 1 second, 9-tenths of a second from first back to fifth spot. That's Jarrett, Gordon, Martin, Terry Labonte, Musgrave, and Bobby Labonte. It's Jarrett, Gordon, Martin, Terry Labonte, and Musgrave. They are the front five. Let me give you that again. Jarrett in first, Jeff Gordon in second, Martin third, and Terry Labonte. And here, down the back straightaway, here's Gordon.
Ernie Irvin slipped up a little bit coming off a two, and that gave Gordon a run on him.
Oh.
And, Mark Martin almost got down on the inside, and he backed out of it, though. So Ernie was not able to get his lap back from his teammate. I thought maybe he'd move over and let him go, but that's how much I know about what Noah Jarrett's thinking out there.
Let me tell you, there are them teammates when the race starts. $320,000 to win the day. These guys are after it.
Yeah, I thought Ned was getting on thin ice out there saying he probably let him go through it. I wonder if that really is true. Wrong. Chad Little having a very good day, and he's had some bad days since he moved up from Grand National, where he had 6 wins a couple of years ago, and last year didn't go quite his way. Thought things were really going to turn around to those new colors this year. Well, maybe they are this afternoon for that green and gold. Number 97.
Jeff Gordon looking to the inside of Dale Jarrett as they head down into turn three. I believe that Jeff Gordon's car is better on long runs than Dale Jarrett is right at the moment. He seems to be quite fast right up out of the corner.
Yeah, his car is really getting off the corner.
But look at Mark Martin in the number 6 pull right in there. Third spot. Mark Martin, winner yesterday, did all that tire testing down here several months ago. As he pushes that Jack Roush car right up through to fight these two leaders. It's a Ford, Chevy, Ford battle, the top three.
Where you gonna represent the race? Something else, not them.
Todd Parent on the radio to Dale Jarrett.
Car leading this bunch right now is Chad Little.
Ooh, and he got a little loose right there.
Just barely in the lead lap, but here comes Jarrett. He had to go because they're putting the heat on him right now.
Martin trying to, Mark him wisely backed off.
Chad Little, who had made up a lap, goes backwards.
He fought a good hard battle, Chad Little did, staying up there as long as he did. He just couldn't get a caution for him to go all the way around the racetrack.
Here's Ernie Irvin underneath him. Meanwhile, Hut Strickland now in jeopardy of going a lap down.
He's trying to hold him up there. He moved to the inside, took the preferred line away from Jarrett. But you see what that did. That put Jeff Gordon right on the inside.
Yeah, Jarrett didn't want to go up on that outside, and I'm proud that he didn't.
Stavola Brothers, number 8. Hut Strickland. Trying to put together a good day here at this new ultra-modern Texas Motor Speedway. West to Fort Worth. Great race here with the top three right now bunched together, bumper to bumper.
And a lot of patience being displayed there, not only with the leader, but Jeff Gordon and Mark Martin. They can get up there and be a little bit more aggressive than they're being right now. Jeff Burton is loving this. He's absolutely driving away from it.
Hut Strickland right now is just hanging on. He's actually holding these three cars up. You can see they close in on him off the corner. And right now they're being very patient, like you said, but sooner or later they're going to have to go on them about their business because all the cars behind them are beginning to chase them down, and this thing's going to be about a 15-car race instead of 2 or 3.
I'll tell you something else that's happening here. This is a break for Jeff Burton as they have to work on Hut Strickland, these three, that if they had some clear sailing, might be pulling along. They just can't get around Hut Strickland, and the advantage is to Jeff Burton in the 14th spot. He's now almost 6 seconds ahead of these leaders as he makes up his lap. Here's Ralf Shaheen.
Ken, I spoke with Richard Broom, the crew chief for Hut Strickland, and he said that Hut's car is a little tight right now through the corners. He's hoping he can hold him off as long as he can, but it looks like it's about to go away.
Gone. Gone in a flash out of turn four. Hut Strickland was in that lead lap, but no more. Top three still all bunched together.
Well, he put up a gallant battle there for a long time, and like Chad Little, he held on as long as he could. Didn't get the caution he needed.
Jarrett, Gordon, Martin, top three. Here's Mike Joy.
Folks, that's the same frustration you feel when you're on the interstate in the fast lane and there's some slowpoke out there who thinks that's his road. Jimmy Fennig is Mark Martin's crew chief, and Jimmy, it looks like Mark is quicker than the leaders right now.
He says the car feels pretty good right now, so he's just back to Ryan. It's pretty hard to pass, so he's just staying in line.
What kind of changes have you been making to make that car better?
Well, we've been a little bit tight, so we freed it up just a little bit, so he's pretty comfortable with it.
Well, he's got a smile on his face because he and Jack Roush and Valvoline just extended their contract for 3 more years. Announced that today, Ken.
I got to tell you, Earnhardt really said it about Dale Jarrett. You know, half of his 10 Winston Cup wins have been in those big races. Earnhardt said, I compare them to a pool hustler. They toy with you for a couple of games. Then when the big money's on the line, that Jarrett, he comes back and takes it all. Boy, they're running on fabric out here at the present time. We'd like to thank Blockbuster for providing CBS Sports with these beautiful aerial views of the new Texas Motor Speedway. At the moment, Mark Martin has taken over in second spot. And here he is on the challenge. It's a Yates car on the outside, Roush on the inside, and whipping down to the bottom. It's Mark Martin out of Batesville, Arkansas, looking to turn things around. Mark Martin, who's gone through 39 races since he won last, really looking good at this moment. Pulling away now from Jarrett.
We're getting a report that Jeff Gordon said his right front tire is going away. He's pushing pretty bad right now and not able to make the moves that he wants to.
See, 135 laps complete, 202 and a half miles as we work toward halfway. And look at Mark Martin begin to pull away. Here comes Gordon getting a little loose there for just a moment. Had to make a correction off that corner. And he does it so well. Keeps it right there in that third spot. But for the moment, you've got Mark Martin as your new leader here. And he drove through for it. Here's Dick Bergman.
And I'm with Ray Evernham. He's with Jeff Gordon. Ray, how's the car behaving?
Well, track position is real critical here, and when it's behind, it gets tight, and when it gets tight, it builds up more pressure in the right front tire, so the worse it gets, and that's what's the matter. We got behind, we had a problem in here in the pit stop, got the car behind, got lost track position, and now the car got tight. When it's out front, it's loose. When it's behind, it's tight.
Oh, the worst of all possible worlds. There's no place it's perfect, but goodness gracious, this guy's still running in third spot.
And he's running pretty good there, too, Dick.
You know, Ned, I'm going to explain what tight and loose means. Ned, you worked with Neil Bonnet a few times. Neil Bonnet used to have the best sayings as far as explaining. But when you push, the front end takes off of the wall. When you're loose, of course, the back tries to come around. But Neil Bonnet used to say, if you're pushing, you see the wreck.
Okay. Boy, you can see how Mark Martin's car just hugs that inside white line. That's the way you want a race car to work.
Roush cars are running first and fifth. That's Martin and Musgrave who deserves a call. Musgrave's done a very good job. There's Ernie Irvin in the 28. This is a moment ago, a few laps back. Watch this.
This is why these guys get paid the big money. You watch the 28 go down in the corner. Watch the back of this car. It gets really loose right here. Most people would have lost control of that race car. He knew to come out of the throttle, turn into the slide, get it slowed down. And he didn't try to force the issue.
You say come out of the throttle. You know, that sounds so easy. You just step off. That's not what they do. They've got to ease back on it. If they don't get it just right, if they come off too quick, they're going to have 3,400 pounds of car leaping into that wall at 190 miles per hour.
It's
trouble with these guys like Baker. They think it's so easy out there because they did it so many years. I mean, I tell you, that hand and eye and foot coordination to get that thing right on the edge all the time and gather it back, that's what makes this so exciting.
And look how close Jarrett was able to move back up on Mark Martin when they got in that lap traffic there. Mark had to wait till he got out of the turn to pass Bobby Hamilton. Jarrett got a good run off the turn, picked back up on him. Mark had built himself up a good 10-car length lead before that happened.
...141 laps are now complete. Roush cars, as we mentioned, first and fifth, and the Hendrick cars are running third and fourth at the present moment, with Terry Labonte, Jeff Gordon, fourth, third, respectively.
You can see Dale Earnhardt's right rear quarter panel is flapping in the breeze, and what that does, it messes up the aerodynamics of the car, and when he starts down in the corner and that starts flapping like that, the air builds up under the rear and makes the car not drive quite as well as it should.
You're watching Earnhardt in the number three. This has not been a good day for Dale Earnhardt. He was caught in an early skirmish. It set him down a lap. He has not been able to make it up, and he's in 19th spot, if you're just joining us. The seven-time champion trying for that elusive number eight. And 1997's being a bit of a bear for him. Moved up to 14th position in the standings. Here you see him right behind Lake Speed.
Uh-oh, uh-oh. Trouble.
Martin. Looks that's like the leader.
The engine might have let go. Caution is out in case there's oil. Probably was as he came off of turn four. So what a tough break for Martin.
Fourth caution is for Mark Martin. Winner yesterday will not win this first Interstate Batteries 500 in Texas.
You can see him pull the car right off the racetrack, down on the flat part of the racetrack. So if there was any liquid coming out of the car, it wouldn't get on the racing surface.
And you can see the smoke coming out the exhaust of that Ford number six. That's bad news because usually that's an internal problem in the car, in the engine.
Windless in 96, trying to put it together here today. Out of Daytona Beach, Florida, native of Arkansas. What a bad day for Mark Martin.
You can tell it's over. He's pulled his gloves off. He is. You see them right on the steering wheel there. He's pulled his gloves off. It's all over.
One of the greatest tributes to this guy was said by Kyle Petty. Said Mark Martin's like a pit bull. Once he sinks his teeth in, he's tenacious and he just does not let go. But he has to today. His motor has gone away.
We'll take a look as he comes off of turn four. Here he is, gliding along in the lead. Has himself a comfortable lead over Dale Jarrett and Jeff Gordon. But look, as he starts off the turn, you see that smoke start coming from those exhaust pipes.
Devoted bodybuilder. That motor was what needed a little more today. The first DNF of the year for Mark Martin. Jeff Gordon. So tender on the throttle, but he pulls it through. You saw that 1-800-MERO2 as we come under caution. That's the number to call if you are interested in becoming a donor in this program for bone marrow. 1-800-MERO2 to Dick Berger.
Well, Dale Jarrett is pitting right now. Todd Bodine is just, Todd Parrott is looking over the wall, handing tires over. And I asked him, how is the car? He said, pretty good. I said, are you going to adjust it? He said, well, a little bit. I said, which way are you going to adjust it? He said, make it better. It's actually just a little tad looser. They stalled it down here. It's not going to hurt him much, but Gordon's going to beat him out of the pits.
Terry Labonte's going to beat both of them out. So is Bobby Labonte.
Mike Joy.
Well, can Ricky Rudd beat them all out of the pits? I'm with Jeff Burton. He needs to make up some ground here because the left front tire wasn't fully tightened on an early pit stop. That's how he got a lap down. But under green a bit ago, he was running faster than the leaders. That's the third Roush Racing car, and they got a good pit stop here.
Yeah, Jeff Burton is back in that lead lap. But now we're getting a report that Dale Jarrett's car may be having a transmission problem.
I don't know. Something happened certainly on the restart there.
We'll get an update on that one in just a moment. One of the leading contenders to win this $3.8 million first race at the Texas Motor Speedway. There you see Dale Jarrett, two-time winner this year. And a gremlin may have got him by the throat. Boy, you talk about a sport, which is a metaphor on the way we live, this is it. Those technical things will get you just when you think you've got it under control.
This CBS Sports Race Summary is sponsored by the more than 1,525 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts and auto parts.
148 laps, 222 miles complete. 8 leaders, 11 lead changes. The average speed up a little, 131.616. Whatever it will be a record. First time out at the Texas Motor Speedway, where 29 laps have been run under the yellow, and these are the cars that have been eliminated from the 43 that started this $3.8 million test. There you see Dale Jarrett's number 88, and that has become the car of consequence and of the moment. Let's see if we can get more on this story. Here's how he left the pits a while ago, trying to bring it up to speed. Clutch problem?
We see they have the left side jacked up, finishing the pit stop over there, and then the car dies all of a sudden. I don't know. I think that he just let the clutch out a little bit quick and the engine died.
Dick Bergeron can tell us more.
Well, you're right, Ned. The engine did die down here, but by the same token, Dale Jarrett said to his crew the word clutch, and at that point, Todd Parrott just put his head on his hands on the war wagon. Now, I asked him specifically. I said, do you have a clutch problem or a transmission problem? He said no, but the driver and the crew chief have had conversation back and forth. Dale says he thinks he has a clutch problem, and his crew chief's trying to persuade him it's just dust on the clutch. We'll see about that. Mike Joy?
Jim Long, the crew chief for Ricky Rudd, made the decision to take on only right side tires and take out one round of wedge. They're experimenting. They want to see if two tires only provides Rudd enough handling so that if there's a late race pit stop, he can take two and be first off pit road like he was this time. Kind of worked at Rockingham. Rudd won that race when he went contrary to everyone else on pit road.
And Mike, during testing down here last month, he told me that he ran 105 laps on a set of tires and testing, so he knows that they're getting good wear here on the surface at the Texas Motor Speedway, so I think that's a smart move. Here we come for the green flag.
Bill Elliott, a lap down on the inside. He's running in 14th spot, trying to get one back. Ricky Rudd squirts out in front as he gets the jump going down there into the turn, and that's the first time that Rudd has led this year. The number 10 of Ricky Rudd out in front. Bill Elliott trying to get a lap back as we head down the back straightaway.
Well, it won't take us long to find out whether two tires work very well or not, because the 5 car of Terry Labonte is the third car in the shot right there, is moving up. You see Bill Elliott trying to make up his lap right now. I don't know whether I'd have took on two if everybody else got four. I believe I'd want some new tires.
Well, like Mike Joy said, though, it's a good test right here in the middle of the race to find out how it might work so that you would know at the end of the race.
Well, they were saying at the outset this might be a Pontiac show, but that's not been the case thus far. As you see Rudd leaping out in front and staying there for the moment. They've completed 150 laps, 225 miles, and at speed, number 88. Might have got touched for just a moment, picks it up as Gordon comes after him. That's the battle for third. Terry Labonte is in second, the 88 in the third spot. Jeff Gordon, number 24, in fourth. In fifth spot, you have Bobby Labonte, but he's been sliding back a bit there. He's gone back two or three spots.
Yeah, he came out of the pits in third place, but Jeff Gordon, Dale Jarrett both got by him. As Gordon now goes by Dale Jarrett and takes over the third position. But Bobby Labonte just running a good, smooth, conservative race here. Still in fifth place, though.
There you see that bone marrow number again. That used to be kind of a harrowing experience. Now they can do it in about 45 minutes in a day. You're back in good shape. And it is something that needs the nation's attention. 2,000 people every day in their battles against some form of leukemia and cancer need that help, and you can help by calling that number right there. Ricky Craven has said all the money in the world isn't an issue or a requirement. What we need is to educate about this bone marrow transplant.
Well, there's some drivers getting a little antsy up front there, Ken, and some trying to get laps back. There's Ernie Irvin moving on the inside of Dale Earnhardt. Jeff Gordon will go by as well. And there's Hut Strickland back up there in the car number 8 in that picture as well. But Ricky Rudd continues to lead.
For the people that are just joining us, Dale Earnhardt was involved in an accident at the very first part of the race. He has a lot of body damage on the race car and it's not up to speed. These cars are just going by him on the inside. He's just hanging on right now.
First lap, first turn, Robbie Gordon, Brett Bodine, Mike Skinner, Todd Bodine, Kyle Petty, Lake Speed, all getting caught there.
And getting caught on the outside was Ricky Rudd. And he loses the lead. Bill Elliott back in the lead lap. Ricky Rudd, maybe a problem. Maybe he didn't.
Yeah.
Just get caught. Maybe he did. I don't know what his problem is.
Ned, I win the first controversy today. I think four tires right now are really working on Rudd. But he is dropping back awful quick. And he may have a problem.
Yeah, he's getting slammed out of that bottom line. And everybody's going by. The other cars in that first accident were Jimmy Spencer and Earnhardt and Hutch Strickland that got the race underway in the very first lap. Here's Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, we've caught up with Mark Martin, who's getting a cool drink of water. Mark, were there any earlier indications that you were having motor problems?
No, man, that thing was awesome. You know, we've been working on it, and we got it out front, and it was just, we were just riding around leading that thing, and I thought maybe it was a good chance for us today to take, you know, Valvoline and Cummins and all those folks in. The tire's just great. Goodyear's got an awesome tire, and, you know, I'm real disappointed that we fell out and broke, but at least we were leading the race.
From what you've seen, what kind of strategy do you think it's going to take to win this thing from the top leaders?
I wish I was still out there. I think, you know, I'd rather be showing you than telling you.
Mark Martin, done for today.
Three times, the last three times that anyone has won on Saturday in Grand National and then on Winston Cup Sunday, it's always been Mark Martin, but not this time. One yesterday, out of it today.
You know, I believe that Ricky Rudd thought for a moment that he might have had a flat tire. When that car slid up on him coming off of turn two and everybody went by him, he drove very gingerly for a couple of laps. He sort of settled in back there now, getting the feel of it, said, well, maybe my tire's not flat. And, buddy, it could be as a result of those hotter, worn tires on the left side not getting the grip.
Well, it could be. And I tell you one thing, when you start running to get somebody with better stick in the corner, you're really, really at, oh, Rusty Wallace almost got into Todd Bodine in the 25 there. He got the back end loose and run right up into the side of Todd Bodine.
And take a look at that number 90. Junie Donlevy's car out of Virginia. Dick Trickle, the driver out of Wisconsin. And 55-year-old Dick Trickle puts the pedal to the metal and goes by Bodine. He is still in the lead lap, and Trickle is in 13th position.
And Sterling Marlin definitely off the pace coming out here. The yellow
touched
number
the wall.
Four.
Right side of that car has a lot of damage. He got into the wall coming out four.
So Sterling Marlin, who was running in the 12th position, actually he was running a little bit further up than that. He was 12th when he came by the start-finish line, but he'd already slowed down, been passed by some cars by then.
Gets it back to speed, but he's flat spotted the side of his car is what he's done.
Yeah, he has to drive gingerly for a lap or two to see how much damage that there might be done on the right side of that Chevrolet. He wants to be sure that there are no tires rubbing against sheet metal.
Ned, that car looks pretty good. He hit right there on the right rear wheel, but what he did was slow down long enough to evaluate whether it was really rubbing the tires bad. And as you see, no smoke, so I think he's back under full thumb now.
Just joining us, Ricky Craven. We mentioned him a moment ago. Let's take a look at this incident on car number four. Yellow car.
And here's trouble off of turn four.
Oh, bad
Rusty
crash,
Wallace.
Rusty Wallace.
Mike Skinner's involved. Sterling Marlin's involved. Brett Bodine is involved. And we had a report that maybe Ted Musgrave might have had an engine problem on his car number 16. And you wonder if there might have been some oil.
Wallace was in 13th position. There you see the remains of the number two.
And they're still wrecking out there. As Greg Sachs comes down through, Ernie Irvin.
Oh, and Jeff Gordon has just crashed. He's gone into the infield.
There's got to be oil up there on the track or something.
Gordon comes to a stop, and the left front of number 24 all torn up. There's Skinner's car, the number 31. That's gone away. The number 20 of Sachs, big impact into the wall. Musgrave may have lost part of an engine and left some oil down and some pieces, and there you have it. Out of turn four, this happening at lap 162.
Well, but Ted Musgrave's car is still out there running around. I don't think he has an engine problem.
Ned, I can add to that. Rusty Wallace's car is losing a lot of fluid as he goes towards the garage area right now. When he got up into the wall there, he may have dropped some fluid on the racetrack.
Okay.
28, Ernie Irvin trying to get his lap back. Instead, he's out of the race. His car was also hit.
Wow, what a strange turn of events.
Rusty Wallace is number two. Big trail of fluid out of the back of his car as it goes back to the garage area. What a moment this. We'll try to get you an update. And there you see Jeff Gordon clambering out of number 24, and his day is over.
Well, at least his chance of winning this race. They'll probably make repairs on that car and get him back out just for points. He was in second place in the points coming into this race.
Ray Evernham out there with him now. Here's Ernie Irvin coming back to the wall. See Mr. Vandercook standing there with Ernie Irvin.
Joey Knuckles on the left there. Let's go to the pits and Dick Berger.
Ernie, you okay?
Yeah.
What happened? He doesn't want to talk for obvious reasons. Ernie Irvin just pushed off and headed to the garage.
To Ralph Shaheen.
I'm down here with Rusty Wallace. Rusty, what happened out there?
Car just got out from underneath me right there. We had the car so loose to try to make a turn. The track is so difficult to drive. It's really something. And, you know, if we come back again to this track, I'll have another chassis set up, that's for sure. But I really believe they're going to have to do a really total reconstruction to get it right, and I'm sure they will. Those guys really want to make this place great, and they'll do that.
Mike Joy?
Jeff Gordon, you look to climb back in it to see if you can get up behind the wall here to fix it. First, how bad's the car?
The front end's knocked out of it pretty good. I hit Ernie pretty good after he ricocheted off the wall up here, but I can't steer it at all. It'll start, and we'll definitely get back out there, but our day of being competitive in this race is over.
What happened?
Well, just a very narrow front straightaway, and somebody trying to race back to the yellow, you know. I don't know what happened. It looks like Ernie got into somebody as he was trying to get his lap back. And, I saw it. I mean, I saw him, but I was, I still was a little bit up to speed. I wasn't fully up to speed. And, I tried to avoid him. And I figured he'd hit the wall and come back, but he just didn't come back fast enough, and I caught him with the left front.
At these speeds, the brakes on these cars are great, but when things happen that close in front of you, it doesn't leave you a lot of options.
Well, really, if I hit the brakes, I'll lock them up and slide right into them. So, I was off the gas and on the brakes lightly, but I was more wanting to maneuver where I need to go. But on that front straightaway there, if there's a car blocking it, you're going to hit it.
Well, if there's any team that can get a car back out there, it's those Rainbow Warriors. And, Ken, it's like driving on ice. If you hit the brakes, you can't steer. And Gordon was trying to steer through it. Didn't make it.
Ernie Irvin trying to make up a lap. It comes to naught. The front end gone on the H car. Let's watch what happens here.
Okay, this is the tail end of the original wreck when Rusty Wallace said he lost it coming off of turn four. Backs hard into the wall. And you see other cars spinning down on the inside. Sterling Marlin in the yellow number four right there. Brett Budine right there in the number 11 car. And I think there's oil. Here comes Jeff Gordon right there. You see coming out through there as he comes by. Well, let's see. Is that Jeff Gordon?
Yeah, it's
No, that's here's the Jeff Gordon and Ernie Irvin situation. Here's Irvin trying
lap
to
car.
Yeah, trying to get his lap back.
Ooh, oh.
Runs right in the back of Greg Sachs. As Ernie was trying to catch the car number five with Terry Labonte, who was leading the race. Then Gordon, of course, comes up and hits Ernie Irvin.
First part of the incident from Rusty Wallace. The end of a Penske car. Rusty Wallace, that one written off. Jeff Gordon now, later.
You see him waving his arm there to let everybody behind him know.
Oh! And there was nowhere for him to go as he came off of there. And I'm sure there was some oil there, buddy, off of Rusty Wallace's car where he came. There definitely was fluid leaking from his car right at that spot on the racetrack as they came around. Of course, Ernie was trying to get his lap back, trying to get up to Terry Labonte as they were coming around to get the caution.
It was like the sky fell onto Jeff Gordon there. There you see those involved in the crash, and that does not include Skinner, who had the front. There he is there in the second group, and Irvin and Trickle, and Sterling Marlin caught up as well. Greg Sachs' car took terrible damage in the back as it was rear-ended by the Ernie Irvin car trying to make up a lap. There you see the Ted Musgrave car, which had been up fourth and fifth much of the day. It's back behind the wall. It had dropped the cylinder, but apparently hadn't lost any oil out of the bottom of it.
Okay, he continued to run around the racetrack, but during this caution he came in, and now they're trying to evaluate the damage and see if there's a chance of getting it back out there.
Ned, let's look again at what happened first with Rusty Wallace.
We'll just listen. Rusty said that the car just got out from under him coming off the turn. Now we'll look out at Jeff Gordon's windshield as he comes there.
He's motioning for everybody to ease off.
Oh. And Ernie Irvin came right back out in front of him.
Well, what caused that was Greg Sachs was, he saw the wreck in front of him and a bunch of cars were spinning in the grass. He backed off just enough, and I think Ernie was trying to make
Ernie
up his lap, maybe
over
looking in the mirror at who was coming up and run right
never
up
saw
on
Sachs. Ralph Shaheen.
Well, we've caught up with Greg Sachs, who's had a rough day all the way around, and it finishes in the worst of ways. Greg, what happened?
Well, it wasn't my day, and the Hardys Ford Thunderbirds taking the worst of it, but I thank God that there was no fire in that incident, and that no one was hurt. I don't think Rusty was hurt. I know I wasn't. I don't know, it's just a situation, you know, the wreck happened in the front stretch. Heck, I was way around the back stretch. I knew the wreck was there. I knew there was oil. Kind of slowed down, ran on the bottom groove, and apparently a couple guys racing for their lap back. I saw him coming, just kept it to the bottom, lined up with Rusty, basically. Heck, if I wasn't there, I guess they would have nailed into Rusty. So I'm just glad that no one was hurt, that's all.
Is racing back to the yellow a dangerous thing?
Well, in most instances, it works real well. You know, NASCAR's got a real good handle on it. None of the guys back in the field generally race for position under yellow. It's just a question on getting your lap back, and most guys use real good judgment and discretion in that regard, especially at this point of the race, but apparently maybe that wasn't the case today.
Dick Bergeron.
Well, the 88 Dale Jarrett is still reporting clutch problems, and now NASCAR has caught him going too fast, leaving pit row. He will have to go to the end of the longest line. I'll tell you what, this crash was so wild that they had sod from the infield actually come onto pit road, and the NASCAR officials had to come here and lift the sod off and put it back in the infield. This was a wild one.
And with it over, Dale Jarrett on these pit stops. There's a tire loose again. That's going to be a penalty for somebody. Perhaps Michael Waltrip. Dale Jarrett, Terry Labonte, Ricky Rudd, 1, 2, 3 after these pit stops.
CBS Sports presentation of the Interstate Batteries 500 is sponsored by the more than 1,525 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by MCI. Is this a great time or what?
Next Sunday, 3 o'clock Eastern, get a special look at the life and development of a special new superstar, Tiger Woods, son, hero, and champion. Jim Nantz narrates with exclusive family movies and interviews with some of golf's greatest legends. That's next week, Tiger Woods, son, hero, and champion. Back to Dick Bergeron here at the Texas Motor Speedway.
And I'm with Ted Musgrave, who is behind the wall. He pulled the plugs out, putting it back in again. What's wrong with the motor in this thing?
Well, just what I thought I was going to do, Family Channel Prime Star. Another good Justice Steed. 2 weeks in a row, disaster strikes. Looks like we lost something in the valve train. We're going to try to get it back out there, maybe run it at 6-7 cylinders just for points, but we're out of contention.
Well, now, Mark Martin lost his motor. You got a valve train problem. Is this all the same thing? And if so, do we worry about Jeff Burton, who's running in fifth spot?
Well, yeah, you know, that's kind of just a fluke to both of us have engine trouble. We never really do with the Roush motors, but something, I don't know what happened. Maybe we're turning them too hard here today to try and keep up them GM cars because they got more downforce. We just try to get some straightaway speed. But like I say, you know, it's just unfortunate for us, you know, we're up in the point standings. These guys worked awful hard, but we'll get back out there.
To Mike Joy.
Gary DeHart's had a car in the top five all day. Texas Terry Labonte is doing his home state proud. What kind of changes have you been making?
Well, we've been tight all day long. You know, we've been working. It's still been tight every time. So I think we're getting closer to getting it just about right. But it's a lot of cautions right now. We'll just see how everything works out.
They'd like to see a long run to see what happens.
Yeah, we need that really bad, long run.
Ken, I've only heard one driver all weekend complain his car was loose, and that was what happened to Ricky Rudd. After he took just those two tires and took out a round to bite, his car got loose. Nobody else has been all weekend.
Let me bring you up to date on where we are. 172 laps complete, 258 miles. Cautions, we've had five of them. They come to about 40 laps at the present time under yellow in this race, and it seems like everyone out here today has been involved. An early incident in the very first moments of the event at turn one. Gordon, Brett Bodine, Skinner, Todd Bodine, Kyle Petty, Lake Speed, Jimmy Spencer, and Dale Earnhardt, along with Hut Strickland, involved in that. Watching Dick Trickle here come in for a tire change. He's up in the 10th spot at the present time. These altercations have come fast and furious through the race, and this latest has knocked out a couple of the leading contenders. It appears that the car of Jeff Gordon is done for the day. The Ernie Irvin car trying to make up a lap, that one is gone. Rusty Wallace was KO'd in that crash as well. So it's been a day where with these very short shoots off this fourth turn and going into one, when you start to have an incident, it's like a bowling alley out here. Mike Joy.
Here's a famed speedster of a different sort, Michael Johnson, world's fastest human. Well, what do you think when you add 600 horsepower to the speed you've got?
It's incredible. This is a lot of fun. This is my first NASCAR race. I'm a Formula One fan, but this is great. Being down here in the pits, just watching these guys. It's a lot of fun.
June 1st, you got a big match race coming up.
Yep, got a big match race coming up. Looking forward to it. And training hard, and hopefully everything will work out on June 1st.
Okay. Ever want to hop into one of these?
This is my thing. Speed is my thing. So I'll be out here going around because I don't live too far from here. So I'll be coming out here, you know, on my days off, just hanging out, going around the track.
Well, great. He's down here in Terry Labonte's pit. Not helping out, but hanging out.
All right.
Have fun.
That's going to be some race on June the 1st against Donovan Bailey. Mr. Johnson's going to go to town. Now we see number 88 being set back to the end of the lead lap. They say he was too fast exiting pit road. Hard to believe when he's way down at the end of pit road. Dick Berggren may have more on that.
With Todd Parrott, his crew chief, the big question is, how's that clutch?
What clutch?
Gone?
Yeah, the one we don't have, yeah. Left the pits a while ago and said the clutch was gone that time. We sat the car down, put the car in gear, he drove out, took nice and easy on the thing, and they got us for too fast down pit road. I just don't understand. Beat the thing I ever seen in my life. 24 car goes behind the wall and then we're too fast down pit road. You tell me.
Well, I tell you that they're going to go to the end of the longest line.
He's going to have a lot of patience and he will be back up front in a little bit.
There you go. Keep an eye on that 88. They're not giving up, Ken.
He has completed every mile this year. Here we are getting set to come down to take green, get this thing back underway. And man, what a start that was.
Bill Elliott got in the side of Terry Labonte getting down into turn one. Bill's trying to get back in the lead lap, and it was just minor contact, but boy, it could have been ugly.
Just 10 cars on the lead lap. Bill Elliott running 11th. He wants back in the lead lap. He's going to do it going into turn three, or at least he's trying. Yes, he has that movement. Here comes Dale Earnhardt.
And he's going to make up the lap as well. And this crowd understands that and responds. On the restart, Labonte first, Rudd second, Ward Burton third. It's Johnny Benson coming by in fourth, and Jeff Burton in fifth with Bobby Labonte sixth, Todd Bodine,
and a car in the wall.
One in the wall.
And boy, that's going to put Dale Earnhardt.
Johnny Benson
spinning twice, picks it back up. What a break for Elliott and for Earnhardt. That's going to put him back.
Not for Elliott.
He fell back.
Terry Labonte got by him. He's trying to get by Earnhardt as he comes back to the flag. They race back here, but Earnhardt had to get that back.
Yes!
Earnhardt has made it.
That was Earnhardt's spotter there.
Cheering him up. Stay there. And he did. Elliott
scrub
fell back.
Dale, scrub them tires. Good job, man. Good job.
Sorry about that. We got a picture of that.
been saying, I hope you have a picture of that. Larry McGriddle, I feel like that was a spotter up on the roof, but a great move by Earnhardt. And Larry McReynolds, you heard him on pit road.
And the fans cheering Earnhardt on as he goes down the front straightaway here. They're happy to see him get back, or many of them at least, happy to see him get back to the lead lap.
Johnny Benson up in the wall and then looping a couple of times in the second turn. Here's what happened.
The yellow car right there. And
Ed, he just got loose. The back end starts around. You see him trying to get it back. He has to feather it out of the throttle. The right rear gets into the wall. And there he goes, rubbing down the side of the wall. Now he's in trouble. He tried to jerk it off the wall. Starts spinning around.
Chad Little getting beneath him and by him. He's got some running behind Strickland coming up on him there.
You see the back end. Now watch him when he gets up here. When he slaps the wall there, it's hard to make yourself stay up there. He jerked it back, trying to get control of the car. Around he goes. You see the roof flaps they employed. Now they're back down.
Lake Speed's car coming up to him there. Here's Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, Johnny Benson's brought the Pennzoil Pontiac down pit road. He's got a little bit of body damage. They changed two tires on the right side of the car. He had been battling a tight situation. They have found that scuff tires are better than the sticker tires, so they've even borrowed a couple extra sets from Kyle Petty. They put the two tires on the right side. Hopefully the body damage isn't too bad. Mike Joy?
Larry McReynolds, you had some tough luck at the start of the race. You just got a little good luck.
Yeah.
But you earned it. You worked hard for it.
I don't believe I've ever wanted to get back on the lead lap as good as we did then. You know, again, still adjusting on the car, but it seems to be responding. We're just a little past halfway.
You know, I really admire the communication between you and Dale. You talked about what you wanted to do on the car. He wanted a change in air pressure. You said that wasn't a good idea. He said okay. I mean, you folks really have a good mutual respect.
Well, you know, again, I think the fans and in the public has been kind of saying that we hadn't been getting along. The communication hadn't been there. And you know, the last time I remember feeling this good about working with a driver was with Davey Allison. And the relationship's there. And we can touch it. We can feel it. We just hadn't quite grabbed it yet, but we're going to get there.
Well, they've gotten a lot closer to it just now, Ken.
I can tell you about that. I sat over there in the truck the other day and listened to those two conversing about what they were going to do to the car, and there was no question that Earnhardt's confidence is still 100% in Larry McReynolds as that crew chief. And what Larry said, I think, is very accurate. They just got to have it come together for them here, and they've just made up a lap to take 11th spot. Here's Dick Bergeron.
I'm with Gary Dehart. He's crew chief for Terry Labonte, the leader. How are you guys missing all this stuff out there today?
I tell you what, Terry's just a good driver, you know, and we're lucky.
But there's a lot of other good drivers who've been in the middle of it.
Yeah, we've just been in the right place at the right time. We've been pretty lucky today. It's been pretty treacherous out there today.
How's the car been?
Car's a little tight right now.
Good enough to win?
Do what?
Good enough to win?
Hope so.
Okay, they'd only led one lap until today. This is their best run of 1997.
I wonder if that was a spotter call, and Bill Elliott, they yelled out there was a caution because he lifted. He'd done so well in getting by with the Earnhardt number three, and now Bill's got to do it again. Terry Labonte has said the only place, he said this morning, only place I see to pass is coming off turn two, coming down the backstretch. That's where they got it. Okay, pace cars in. We're at lap 179 as they come back under green. 334 the distance.
Here comes Bill Elliott on the inside, the big M there on the hood. He's trying to make up a lap right now.
Terry Labonte in first, Rudd in second, number 22. Ward Burton finds himself in third. Bobby Labonte, number 18, in the fourth position and running in fifth. It's number 99, Jeff Burton, followed by number 25, Todd Bodine, has got himself up into sixth position in that Ricky Craven car. Look at that 18 on the outside, Ned. Fourth place there, mixing those lap cars.
Yeah, and he's trying to get by Chad Little, who is a lap down. Chad Little in the green car on the inside of Bobby Labonte.
You're riding with Bobby Labonte right in the middle of turn one and two. You can see right now Chad Little fighting back on the inside. That outside lane is still not quick enough to make those moves on the outside yet.
A lot of rumpled race cars, including that Pontiac number 18, the Joe Gibbs car that's being driven by Bobby Labonte. Jeff Burton squirts down to the inside. He tries to find some running. Remember, Jeff has come back to fourth.
Jeff Burton's had an incredibly good year on the super speedways. Been in the top five on each and every occasion.
You can see him telling the cars, we talk with the sign language. It's very similar because you don't have any turn signals or anything to let the car behind you know what's going on. So you use a bunch of hand signals inside the car to let the guy behind you know when cars are slowing up in front of you so that you don't get rear-ended.
1994 Rookie of the Year, Jeff Burton, having a great... And we have a caution once again. They say there's an oil down somewhere around this mile-and-a-half facility. See Musgrave coming back onto pit road. And as they race to the line, it'll be Terry Labonte to the stripe. Hut Strickland trying to make up a lap directly behind him and not doing so. Field comes across with Labonte, Rudd, Jeff Burton, the top three. Followed by Ward Burton, fourth, Bobby Labonte, fifth, Dale Jarrett, sixth, Todd Bodine, seventh, Earnhardt, eighth. There is no altercation on the track, no wreck, but there...
Could have been.
Could have been.
With that oil out there.
Don't want any of those could have been. Earnhardt, eighth, Sterling Marlin, ninth, Benson, tenth, Dick Trickle stays 11th. Maybe we can show you what happened.
Oh, yeah, big plume of smoke coming out of the back of the 16th, Ted Musgrave, down the back straightaway.
Well, we speculated earlier that we had a report that he'd blown an engine. He really has now. We were just a little premature. He had lost a cylinder earlier, but now she's gone.
So that's the second of the Roush cars to blow up today.
Very unusual.
Saw it happen to Mark Martin, and now we see it in the case of Musgrave, and that leaves one Roush car running, and that's that 99 of Jeff Burton in the third spot, trying for his first Winston Cup victory. There you see it. Third spot coming by. Terry Labonte stays in front. He wants to win this so bad. It's the first race at this super speedway near Texas. The Texan from Corpus Christi wants to pull it off. On this inaugural day, Blockbuster giving you these pictures. Pleased to be a part of the great event, the first Winston Cup race to be held at this new Texas Motor Speedway. Beautiful shot. CBS Sportsline rolls on. Get online. Stay on top of your favorite sports with updates, breaking news, scores, and more. It's all at cbs.sportsline.com. CBS Sportsline. Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Ted, this is something we don't see too often. Two Roush motors blowing up on the same day. Do you think yours let go the same way Mark's did?
It's an eval train. When we got here, Mark tested here, so James said, do everything that Mark does and you'll be in good shape. Well, maybe not everything. I'll tell you, just when I figured I was going to do Prime Star Family Channel or Family Channel Prime Star, just another good deed, you know, 2 weeks in a row and get up in the point standings, it just came out from underneath us. You know, like I say, it just started running on seven cylinders and we fell back, but we were still running sixth or seventh, and I thought maybe it would hold up for the rest of the day, but it didn't. It finally dropped the valve and destroyed the rest of the motor, so... We're out, but, you know, like I say, I feel real good because the team is there, the people are there, we're working hard, we got good cars, and we're up near the front all the time now. It just misfortunes are setting us back, so hang in there, we'll be there at the end.
Rusty Wallace said this track needs to be totally reconfigured. Do you think it's that bad?
It needs some adjustments, yeah, for side-by-side racing. I think a lot of frustrations are going on right now because of all the wrecks. It's producing wrecks in a lot of one-lane racing. It doesn't need totally reconfigured, but it just needs some, it needs a little work, and I know Bruce Smith will do that because he's heard that throughout the weekend. And we'll come back and it'll be changed. It'll be all right.
Ted Musgrave, who has had some great finishes, second at Darlington behind Jarrett. Now we're going back under green as they come by. 187 laps complete. And there you see Terry Labonte leading the way. Ricky Rudd right there in second spot.
That's Strickland trying to get a lap back as he comes off on the inside of Terry Labonte. He's going to drag him down the backstretch. He'll get into that turn first, maybe. And if he does, he should come out first in front of him, and that would put him back in the lead lap. Indeed, he does. Labonte has to back off in that high groove.
Now 12 cars in the lead lap, and it could be 13 as here comes Elliott.
Elliott's up under the quarter panel there of Rick, of Terry Labonte, and you see Ricky Rudd looking to take the lead there.
Ricky Rudd looking really racy out here in this one. Not until today has he had an opportunity to lead, and he likes it, and he's been fighting with him. Now, here comes Labonte back. Elliott fighting to get back in that lead lap. Got it. Can Rudd come with him? Oh, something wrong on Strickland's car. He pulls in. Hunt Strickland had just made up that lap, falls off the pace and onto pit road.
Bill Elliott's caught on the outside. You see Terry Labonte move right on by him on the inside there.
Bye-bye, Billy. That's tough when you get hung out there. Wild Bill just got tamed a little by Terry Labonte.
Bill Elliott in 12th position. 11 cars on the lead lap.
Look at Earnhardt up to fifth. Thank you very much.
Chrome horn, beep, beep. Thank you.
Yeah, he just ran in on some traffic there a moment ago. Got on the inside of Dale Jarrett, blew right on by, took over the fifth position.
Terry Labonte, Ricky Rudd, 1 and 2. Jeff Burton in third, Ward Burton in fourth, and Earnhardt comes to fifth. The man in black is back. First lap, first turn, stuffed in the wall. Been a lap down for more than half of the distance. Now he's up here fighting. He's made his lap up. Ralph Shaheen.
Keanu, it was a clutch that let go on the 8 car of Hunt Strickland there, pushing him back behind the wall.
Strickland for the Stavola brothers made it all the way up into that lead lap. And then after just one lap in that lead lap, gone. Lake Speed. Going a little high, and down comes Earnhardt. That was a lap car.
Lake Speed in 16th position. He is one of those cars that's one lap down.
Meanwhile, out in front, there it is, number 5, the Cal Ripken of racing, Terry Labonte, 543 consecutive starts, and he wants to win this more than anything. Donated his purse yesterday to this bone marrow drive for the National Council. And here he is drawing away now. That's the biggest lead anyone has enjoyed all afternoon. You're seeing it right there. Dick Burford.
40-year-old Ricky Rudd, who is running in second spot right now, looking for his 18th career Winston Cup win, came into this event with a very decided strategy. He figured the place to pass, the place to be fast, is cutting off the fourth corner. And he figured the way to do that was get a car that did not push. He wanted a car that was a little loose there. Well, he's got one, but it's a little too loose there. On the other hand, crew chief Jim Long says as the time wears on, as the laps wear down and the fuel load burns off, the car gets a lot better. Watch for Rudd to get quicker coming off the fourth turn and try to make up some ground there.
Well, they better all start looking at third place car right now. Jeff Burton has really moved in on the trunk lid there of Rudd as they start down into turn one. Burton is really, really putting a lot of heat on him, as you can see.
Mike Joy.
He is, Buddy, and Buddy Parrott's got the big smile on here. You had a tough day to start, had a trouble in the left front, got a lap down, made it back up, and for the last 20 or 30 laps, it looks like you've been the quickest car on the racetrack.
I'll tell you what, Jeff's done a great job. The 24's got a saying, never refuse to lose. We decided we weren't going to give up. We had a problem and got a lap down. We knew we had a great race car. Exide Battery Ford. I can't say enough about the pit crew. They bounced back, had a great pit stop. We're back in the game, and I just hope we can pull this thing off. The last time I was in Texas, I was with Darrell Waltrip, and we won the race.
Burton up to second spot, looking for that all-elusive first-ever win.
I think Parrott can make a play-by-play announcement.
Oh, gosh,
yeah. He got it all over there.
Sir.
There's Jeff Burton, number 99, in second, the man he's talking about, and Buddy Parrott, one of the great crew chiefs, and his son, Buddy Parrott's son, is the crew chief for Jarrett, running back in fifth, but Earnhardt is the story at the moment. Earnhardt's mowing him down. He's up into fourth spot.
Just passed Ward Burton a couple laps ago, the Dales did. Took over the fourth and fifth spot. Ward Burton running in sixth. He's right behind him there. He's not too far.
What it is, every time we come, it's the Dale and Dale show. What is this? Terry Labonte stays up in front. A lot of determination on his part. Nothing would mean more to this guy from Corpus Christi, Texas, who was brought on the scene years ago. This Royce over at Talladega. Billy Hagan brought him in. And he is flying today.
watching Earnhardt, this number three, trying to get some distance on the 88. And here comes Dale Jarrett right back up on him. Kenny Wallace in the 81 right there.
I think the three car, Earnhardt and Jarrett, are very evenly matched. But Jeff Burton has really turned the wick up. He's running their leader down now. He's only about, I'd say, 10, 15 car lengths back from Terry Labonte, and Terry had almost half a straightaway just a second ago.
We saw Kenny Wallace. He was running in 14th spot. You see some of the speeds out here right now.
You are riding with Jeff Burton down the front straightaway, and just in front of him is Terry Labonte, our leader. You can see him visibly closing in.
Dramatic picture through that 24-degree banking. Riding with Jeff Burton. South Boston, Virginia now. Kenny Wallace giving some ground in the 14th place car, pulling to the outside. The three in the 88, zipping down through on the bottom.
Kenny Wallace, one lap down, having a good run here today. He got a lap down early in the race. Had some handling problems, got seemed to be straightened out, running good.
300 miles in the books, 200 laps complete.
Ned, we're riding with Dale Jarrett as we start down in the corner. Watch the three car go right on the bottom and watch Dale Jarrett drift up just a little bit.
Now here, Ernie Irvin's just been released from the care center in the infield. He put 6 stitches in his chin, buddy. He did get cuffed out there.
He had a hard leg.
Yeah, that's the late report.
Well, Greg Sachs was running about 50 miles an hour, and he was running probably 140, 150, and when he got in the back of Sachs, that was a very, very severe lift.
Here's some really good news. Ricky Craven has been released from the hospital. He crashed back here a couple of days ago, and his car is being driven by Todd Bodine this afternoon. He's running in 7th spot. But Ricky Craven, broken shoulder, broken ribs, concussion. He's out of the hospital, headed home. Took a really hard look in the initial practice session for Winston Cup cars on this mile and a half. Here's Ralph.
Ken, Andy Graves is a crew chief on the 25 car that Todd Bodine is driving. You told me this morning you thought a top 10 was feasible. You're 7th right now. How about a top 5 and maybe even a win?
Yeah, I think right now we've got a top 5 car for sure. Maybe we can get about a 3rd or 4th place finish out of it, but old Texas Terry's just flying right now, and I think it's going to be pretty hard for anybody to catch him.
Yeah, but you also told me that this guy drives like him and the setups are similar. How similar are they now?
They're real similar. Todd reminds me a lot of Terry. He's real smooth, but we'd like to wish Ricky Craven, hope he gets well soon and get him back in the Budweiser car.
Well, you'll be happy to hear he's on his way home.
There you see Todd Bodine in the Hendrick number 25, giving it a good ride today. Todd Bodine currently 7th place here in the Interstate Batteries 500. ...209 laps are on the board, 313 and a half miles, and Terry Labonte wants to make it a Texas getaway here as he continues to extend his lead. He's now out in front by 2 1/10 seconds. Here's Steve Grissom. He's been running very well, but just had Earnhardt blow by him with Jarrett, but he's running in 12th position. And there you see Michael Waltrip going by. Steve Grissom, who had that horrendous crash at Atlanta. He says racing is a way of humbling you, but he's giving a good showing in that number 41 at the present time. Failed to qualify for Darlington. Great job out here in Texas for Steve Grissom.
He's running one lap down, but still 15th position.
Played high school football in Alabama, had a chance at a scholarship, but he said, Winston Cup racing is all I've ever wanted to do.
You see Jeff Burton there in the 99. Ed, he made a severe run trying to catch Terry Labonte, but I think he may have abused his tires because you see Ricky Rudd running back down there in the 10 car. He's closed in almost a half a straightaway on Jeff Burton.
And while he was gaining on Labonte a little bit ago, now Labonte is just driven away from him, and you're right. Rudd has pulled back up on him. You can see in the corners is where he's really getting. Look how much Rudd moves up as they head off the turn.
And where it was like 2 1/10, It's now over 3 seconds between Terry Labonte.
Oh, he's off to pace.
Way off is the 99.
No, I think he backed off and let Ricky Rudd go. He didn't want him up there.
Well, on his back. Yeah, I thought when he pulled over there, I thought Roush was going to have. He started with three and had trouble with the other two cars, and now Jeff Burton is the only one left in a Roush Ford out there.
Terry Labonte drawing away. Now it's 3 4/10 seconds. Old Texas Terry has got the wind up his tail today. He is flying. He intends to win this thing. You don't come from Corpus Christi, Texas, represent the Lone Star State, and come to the Lone Star's new $120 million track and run for anything but the top spot. That's just what number five is doing right now.
And those boys will be my age before Terry Labonte makes a mistake, anybody out there, because he just does not do anything on the racetrack that gets himself in trouble.
The Iceman looking pretty cool. Mike Joy.
Ken, Jeff Burton is okay. Nothing faltered in that power plant. He says it's the worst the car has handled all day, and that's why he just got out of line. He's having trouble keeping the car down on the racetrack. Says the worst we've ever been. He doesn't think changing the air pressure, lowering it on the right front is the way to go. They'll try something else next time. And look up on the leaderboard. Who are the two best slick track drivers in NASCAR? Terry Labonte and Ricky Rudd. And Labonte is pulling away at a rate of 0.2 seconds. The crew is just telling him to take it easy.
Yeah, but you've got a couple more stops in this thing. I mean, on pit road, we may get some cautions as well out here. But anything can happen. You get that car on pit road, it changes the whole equation as to how the car works. Hey, there's Michael Waltrip, the 21. Now, remember Michael Waltrip early in the race? He's still a lap down, but he lost that lap on a stop-and-go penalty head early in the race.
He has basically run with the leaders. He has run fast enough to stay in the lead lap, but you're right. They caught him speeding on pit road, had to come back down pit road, and they got him a lap down, and that's where he's been ever since then. His car's not fast enough, or hasn't been so far, to get back in the lead lap, but he has run basically with the leaders since then.
Grissom has dropped back into 15th, and up to 12th is that car you just saw, the Michael Waltrip number 21.
You see Dick Trickle there. He was in the lead lap for a long, long time, but he has somehow damaged the right front corner on that car, and he's really aerodynamically a brick now.
He was involved in that big skirmish here on the front straightaway and got hit, and of course that did a lot of damage to his car.
Ralph?
That's exactly right, Ned, but the interesting thing about Dick Trickle is he's crew chiefing from inside the cockpit. They released a crew chief that had been working on that car, Bob Johnson, earlier in the week, and Dick has been making all the calls on that car while he's been out on the racetrack. All they've been doing is basically dealing with air pressures. He felt the car was pretty good until the incident on the front straightaway. If they can keep it dialed in or close to it, he might be up in the top 10 before the day is over.
Junie Dunleavy, the owner, told me the other day, he said, look, what do I need a crew chief for? Trickle's going to make all the calls anyway. He can do that from inside the car. I just need to have some folks work with me to get the thing running. There's Earnhardt. He's in third. Jarrett right with him. What a good race we're getting out of this thing.
This CBS Sports Race Summary is sponsored by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car.
At 220 laps, 330 miles, we've had 8 different leaders. The lead has been swapped 12 times. The average speed way down at 123.7, but that's almost expected when you have an inaugural race the first time out. And those 7 cautions for 50 laps, that's why that speed is down there. And 12 of the 43 starters are back in the garage area, pretty well hammered.
Yeah, a lot of them had accidents, had a few out with the engines, but wrecks have taken most of those out that are sitting in the garage area.
There you see Terry Labonte now leading by 4 6/10 seconds. Terry Labonte in that lead over Ricky Rudd in second, Jeff Burton number 99 in third, and Earnhardt in fourth with Dale Jarrett fifth.
You know, you would probably say, why does he not slow down? He's pulling away from second place. But you get into a rhythm, and if you ever break that rhythm, then you start making mistakes. As long as you know you're not abusing the car and run constant laps, you can stay in sync. Once you break it, it's like a great running back trying to walk through a play on the football field.
He sure is smooth.
He knows the limits of his race car,
He has a great feel for the car, and he knows how hard he can drive it, and expected to be there at the end, and expect to maintain control.
One of the most incredible stories I ever heard in racing was about Terry Labonte testing tires at Talladega for Goodyear. He was there for 3 days, and on the end of the third day, they slapped a set of tires on the car and sent him out around that 2.6-mile track. When he brought the car in after 15 or 20 laps, they said, how did they feel? And Terry Labonte said, gee, they feel just like the tires I used the first day we were here, the second time out. And they were. Here's Dick Bergman.
And I'm with Todd Parrott. Now, usually if you've got a clutch gone in your street car, that's it. You can't move the thing at all, but you're out there running in fifth spot. How can you run so well with a bad clutch?
You got a driver with a real big heart. Now, we got a... Just the clutch isn't working, leaving the pits. Got that Jericho transmission in there, and everything seems to be shifting okay. You know, right now the car's it's tight on entry and tight off the corner, but it can get loose too. So we're fighting a lot of things right now, and just want to get a pit stop here, adjust on it a little bit, and hopefully get this thing back up front.
How soon will you pit if it stays green?
About 8 laps, looking at it.
It stops coming up soon, guys.
8 laps away from caution as Terry Labonte continues to lead. There you see that 88, Todd Parrott's car.
What's happening to Dale Jarrett right now happened to Bill Elliott in Daytona. They're using a road race transmission in this car, and you really don't, it does not have a synchronizer, so what you do is get the motor turning up, then you just kind of use the momentum to push it into gear, the square cut gears instead of angle cut gears. And they're about the size of my head, so they're big things, and they're hard to abuse. I didn't say as hard as my head. I said the size, okay?
Labonte's lead now goes up to 6 seconds. What a story on Texas Terry. The guy they said was washed up. Nobody was going to give him a chance. And then in 95, he won 3 races. Richmond and Pocono and Bristol. Rick Hendrick put him in, replaced Ricky Rudd. There you see Ricky Rudd. He's in second spot, the man that Terry Labonte replaced in the Hendrick stable. And after that winless streak of some 5 years, back he came, 10th in standings in 95. Then in 96, the champion again, and he's certainly looking like a champion here this afternoon. Up behind Jeff Bodine in 18th position, here comes Texas Terry.
Trying to put Bodine 2 laps down. And the 41 car of Steve Grissom being given the black flag for some reason. Apparently something wrong with his car.
Backed up to 14th spot is Grissom.
Ned, you can see Terry get a good run up off that corner. He thought better of that outside move there, and he just kind of checked up and let... Now he just waited his time, passed down the back straightaway, and everything's fine.
The crew wants that 41 car in. Must be there without a radio, and they've requested to bring Grissom in, and there he is.
Okay, this could be a scheduled pit stop for him.
That was not a NASCAR call. Crew wanted number 41 on pit road. Radio problem, perhaps. Almost for sure.
And here's Ward Burton coming in for a pit stop. Todd Parrott mentioned that Dale Jarrett will be coming in a few laps, so now pit stops, green flag coming up.
Sixth place for number 22, Ward Burton. Bill Davis's cars had a terrific run at MBNA car this afternoon. Labonte. His lead back to 5 7/10 seconds. What a thing if he can pull this off. Coming back to Texas and running this well with a Chevrolet this afternoon for Rick Hendrick. And there you see he's led 78 laps, Ned.
Yep. Boy, you got that Chevrolet running smooth. Chad Little in the pits for a pit stop.
Here he comes. The leader onto pit road. As the leader comes in, Ricky Rudd goes into first spot.
So no, Ricky Rudd coming into the pit.
And here's Rudd coming in.
Jeff Burton will go into first spot.
You've got it. First and second on pit road.
Dale Jarrett coming in.
Well, I was just about bet that Burton or Jeff Burton will be in the pits on the next lap. He needed those 5 points.
To Mike Joy.
Gary Smith and Brad Diamond bring the tires around to the right side for Richard Labby and Mike Bumgarner. Walter Smith hauls that jack around to the left side, and with one pump, it's up in the air. Jeff Torrance with fuel. Ray Labby has the second can of gas in. Fuel is done. A little long time there on the left rear. Labonte is away. He'll be able to preserve a lot of that lead. Here's Dick Bergren.
Dale Jarrett so far is having a really good start, but here comes the hard part with no clutch. He's got to shut the engine off. Crew's got to push him, and off he goes. Not a bad stop for no clutch.
20.4 seconds on Terry Labonte's stop.
Jeff Burton's in the pit now, and everybody's starting to come in the pits here, and they'll get back in the cycle now, and we'll see how they shake out after their pit stop.
And I think Dale Earnhardt's going to lead for the first time since Daytona.
That's the case.
He led the Daytona 500, and now he comes into the pits. He stayed out there and to lead a lap. Now he comes in. Let's go to the pits and Mike Joy.
Jeff Burton wanted a change. They went back to a set of tires like the last set they had, Buddy Parrott said, and made a track bar adjustment. Terry Labonte said all he wanted was a set of tires just like the ones he had. Dick Berggren.
Earnhardt is in right now. This is a whole new bunch of guys working on the car. Jimmy Ellinger is on the front tires. Mark Armstrong now works the rears. Mike Moore is on the jack. The only real veteran still left on this team. Chocolate Myers, he is the gas man. Out back, four tire change. Looks good so far. Done. Earnhardt's gone. To Ralph.
Todd Bodine brings the Budweiser Chevrolet down pit road into a stop. Dave Denning gets to jack up underneath the car. Shane Parsnow goes to work on the front. Kevin Gilmore on the rear. And Rick Coulson putting the gas in. They're real happy with this car. They're going to just make very, very minor changes to the car. They're real comfortable with it. Todd's getting real comfortable with the Hendrick crew. He even ate Kellogg's Pop-Tarts for breakfast today.
You can see Todd doing his hands, just relaxing them a little bit. You hold that steering wheel, he was releasing there and trying to get all the muscles working again.
Sterling Marlin inherited the lead. He is now on pit road in number four. The two-time Daytona 500 winner, Marlin, pitting in the Morgan McClure car.
And Ken, I could have been a little bit premature on Earnhardt. He came in, he was in the lead, but he came in the pits on that lap. And by the time he got to the start-finish line on pit road, yeah, Todd Bodine had already passed him out of the racetrack, so I don't believe that Earnhardt led a lap.
No, he didn't get the 5 points. Here's Dick Berggren.
Sterling Marlin just left the pits, and what a great job these guys are doing today. The whole back end of that car is pushed in from an earlier altercation, and they've gotten themselves repositioned on the racetrack. They were in the lead at that moment. You'd never believe it if you looked at this thing.
Yeah, they look like short track cars out here in this mile and a half. Here you see Terry Labonte back at work another time as we sort them out after a stop under green. As we get closer to the finish, we are down to 239 of 340 laps complete. Webster Hubbell, the man in the eye of the storm, now swirling around the president, unburdens himself to Mike Wallace tonight on 60 Minutes. That's followed by Touched by an Angel and the CBS Sunday movie, Louisa May Alcott's The Inheritance. That's tonight on CBS. Hope you'll enjoy it.
Jeff Gordon back out on the racetrack. Many, many laps down, of course.
You're like 148 and 39th position, but trying to get those points. And remember, he came in here today, Jeff Gordon, 87 points behind Dale Jarrett. Gordon is 80 laps behind. They're now showing him, what, in 33rd? He's already made up a few spots on some of those cars that were wrecked.
Yeah, some of those that have dropped out. Ted Musgrave would be the next one that he could pass if he makes enough laps.
Terry Labonte, the story. By 6 seconds, he continues to lead at this time. For more on that story, let's go to Mike Joy.
Gary Dehart is perched up on the war wagon here, and Gary, Terry said on that last pit stop he wanted a set of tires just like his last set. How long will he have to run before he knows if he got a set that works the same way?
Well, I already know right now it's not as good as the other set was, but all of them are good. Just some of them seem to be a little bit better than others. This set here is a little bit older, but we're still leading anyway. That's the main thing.
Are you hoping for a caution so you can get one more set on there, or would you like to see this go green the whole way?
I'd like to see it go green all the way.
When you're the leader, that's a good idea, Ken.
Yes, yeah, sir.
You bet he wants it to go green all the way.
Yeah, when he has that lead that good.
The 18 and the 25, this for seventh spot. Bobby Labonte just in front of number 25. Todd Bodine, the Ricky Craven ride. The good news, Ricky Craven out of the hospital this afternoon. Broken ribs, broken shoulder. Still wants to be at Bristol next Sunday.
doubt it. I'm sure he'll be there. Tough kid out of the New England area.
Ed, that makes me a little homesick when I look out that windshield like that. So many years I looked out there. I don't know. This looks a lot like Charlotte, but everybody says, no, not quite.
Well, no, so many years that Buddy Baker looked out that windshield and all the success that he had. We'll get him in the International Motorsports Hall of Fame a little bit later on this month. Congratulations.
Hey, buddy. While we're talking about that, do you know who we have sitting to our right? Whoa, we've got
a little trouble coming off turn two.
That is Grissom in the wall. Steve Grissom's number 41 is going to bring out the eighth caution in this 500-mile race. Looks like the left front tire is down on number 41. Grissom running in 13th place.
Well, let's see if we can figure what happened to Steve as he went into turn two. There he is. He's the white car going into the turn.
Ned, right by itself, you see him veer off there. That usually means that there's something that keeps that car from turning. Now he's up on the high side where you see all the dust flying. There's a lot of debris up there. Once you get up there, the back end just come right around on Steve.
Looked like maybe the right front tire was going down or something as Rick Mass looks like is headed
to
the garage area and maybe dropped some oil. So that probably was Steve Grissom's problem.
They say that that Mass car blew up. Butch Mock's car, and there you have it. We'll continue after a message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports presentation of the Interstate Batteries 500 is sponsored by Wrangler, real comfortable jeans, and by Pennzoil, formulated for today's stop-and-go driving. Stop-go Pennzoil.
Well, welcome back to the Texas Motor Speedway. Great day for racing here, huh, Ned?
Great day, and I'll tell you, it's been an interesting race, a strange race, a lot of accidents out here, and we sort of anticipated that might happen.
Yeah, and of course, Baker can tell you all about racing in Texas. Remember that race in Texas, buddy?
Which one, Ken?
Not the one you won, the other one.
Oh, I thought that was the one you were talking about.
Of course, Baker won down there at Texas World Speedway in the two-mile track. And then in, 1969, leading by two laps, 4 miles, had it covered. Huh? What happened?
Well, I was reading a sign that said, you have it made, with a big dollar sign. As I turned back to see what was on the racetrack, James Hilton had slowed down, and I run in the back of him.
Lost the race.
Square in the back of him.
Oh, that's tough.
But I won 2 years later.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
69. Oh, you don't want to talk about that.
And that helped to get him in the Hall of Fame, of course.
Of course, right. Hey, let me tell you about what's coming up. The life and time of Bobby Jones is part of a very special golf weekend. CBS Sports Show presents this portrait of Bobby Jones, a documentary style looking at the legendary golfer who was co-founder of the Masters and the Augusta National Golf Club. That's going to be Saturday at 2:30 Eastern, and it's worth the seeing, the story of Bobby Jones. So, I think we're just about set to get flying again here. What are we at, 252 laps?
And Ricky Rudd got out of the pits first.
We'll take a quick commercial break and then get back for Green Flag Racing here at Texas Motor Speedway. Ready on a restart with 254 laps now complete. What, less than 80 getting down? Oh, they're going to put caution out again. You're unfurling the yellow another time. Had an oil down situation here. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, a lot of that oil could be traced to the Remington car of Rick Mast. Rick, what went wrong with your motor?
Well, I don't know. You know, the first lap when Daryl and those guys wrecked in the first turn, I got caught up in that and knocked the car all out of whack. You know what I mean? We kept pitting each time trying to get it straightened back out. It was messed up, but you know, we figured we'd hang in there and run all day. You know, everybody kept wrecking and falling out. We'd have a decent finish. Finally, something let go under the hood, but the way it goes.
Rick Mast is done.
Tough one for Rick Mast, and it just seemed to get tougher and tougher for him. Mike Joy?
Larry McReynolds making his notes here. I'll tell you, who would have believed an hour ago if you'd gone to the icebox, you'd come back and find that car in the front four, and is it as good as you can make it right now?
Yeah, I tell you, as hard as it is to pass here, and we were sitting about 43rd about at the beginning of this race. Yeah, it was hard to believe we'd be back on the lead lap. But, again, we felt like we've had a car ever since we unloaded here and just had that bad luck in the beginning and kind of got a mix-up on the pitting. And here we are in fourth, still got 80 laps to go. Five car looks awfully strong. We just have to see what happens.
Four tires and a change of the track bar. What will that change do for you?
Well, again, just still won't quite turn off the corner like it should, so hopefully raising that track bar, raising the rear row center, make it turn just a little bit better.
We're about to find out.
116 miles to go to decide this first ever Interstate Batteries 500. Dick Berggren.
We're seeing something down in the pits that we have not seen since the advent of radial tires, Ken Squire. People are down here with tape measures, and they are measuring the size of the tires, and we are getting reports of left rear tires growing. That hasn't happened with the radials. Not ever, but it seems to be happening here, and it may somehow explain why people say this track is tight. They have something to do with the way the tires are behaving.
Another lap of caution, Dick, as the field comes by. Unfurl the yellow still another time as Dick Trickle is in and out, and that will get us down when they take green to 114 to go beginning Thursday. CBS Sports presents a tradition unlike any other. The Masters. Highlights begin after your local late news on Thursday and Friday. Then full coverage begins Saturday at 3:30 Eastern and final round coverage Sunday at 4 Eastern. The Masters on CBS Sports. It's a great tradition. By the way, talking about tradition for just a moment, our congratulations, right, Baker?
Absolutely.
Honorary doctorate is going to be given from Lenoir Rhine University in humanities.
So what do we call him? Dr. Ned?
Dr. Ned Jarrett. I'm so pleased for you.
Well, thank
deserving
you.
Deserving, and after all the work you have done for this sport over so many years and in humanities. That's a nice touch.
Well, I'm very honored, Ken, that the Board of Trustees of Lenoir Rhine College of Hickory, North Carolina bestowed this honor upon me, and it'll be given out during the Bacular sermon and other things.
I want to be sure. You're going to be there?
Because,
they're going to give you 3 years to show up.
No, I'll do it. I'll be there.
Congratulations.
There's some surgeons fixing to go back to work right now, I'll guarantee you, and they better be online.
All right. Ricky Rudd leads that group with Terry Labonte in second, Jeff Burton in third, Dale Earnhardt fourth, Dale Jarrett fifth, Ward Burton sixth, Bobby Labonte in seventh, Todd Bodine followed by Sterling Marlin, Johnny Betts in the top ten, Chad Little a lap down in 11th.
Dale Jarrett off to a very slow start. I don't know if it's that clutch or what his problem was, but he got a very
fast Johnny Benson loses it coming off turn two.
Down to the inside. He didn't get it. Oh!
Joe Nemechek.
Nemechek wraps him. Unbelievable. Joe Nemechek getting collected as they race back to the line. Rudd's going to stay there in first. Johnny Benson looping for the second time today, and this time takes a hard hit right in the nose. The drivers are saying some of the drivers are reporting in to their crew chiefs that there was so much speedy dry they couldn't get a bite.
Had a tough break for both. And here's Chad Little. A lot of damage to his car as well. Chad was running up there in 12th position.
Yeah, looking for his first top 10 of the season. Remember, he ran back in 1991 up there at Charlotte in the top 10. He was trying to do it today and had such a good run going. That John Deere car, it's over for him.
And here is Joe Nemechek. Looks like he's coming out of his car, and that's good. He laid his helmet out on the roof of the car, and certainly our condolences and best wishes continue to go out to the Nemechek family. Lost his brother John a couple of weeks ago in a truck accident. Yes, he is.
Taking his time getting out, taking deep breaths, and he may have broken some ribs. He took an awful hit.
But thank goodness he crawled out of the car himself.
He nods affirmatively, but
you can see Johnny Benson going back to console him a little bit and tell him what happened. Certainly Johnny Benson, one of the nicest guys in all of racing. He goes back to make sure that Joe Nemechek is all right.
Well, there's the two of them. A hard hit. Limping is Johnny Benson after that crash. Johnny Benson, former Rookie of the Year from Grand Rapids, Michigan. And two excellent drivers.
Benson, who has been successful in so much racing. Sister runs his fan club, and the folks up around Grand Rapids are so proud of him. And Nemechek chatting with Benson now. Nemechek, really tough luck this year. Crashed in Daytona, crashed at Atlanta, a victim of an unavoidable accident today. Holding his ribs.
Yes, I think on the left hurt. Side there.
Yep. Misfortune following the Nemechek family here in 1997.
And one of the fine families of motorsports, the Nemechek family, just great, great people.
Indeed. The number 22 car, Ward Burton, back on pit road. Right side up, Dick Trickle in and coming out again. Nine cars remain in the lead lap.
We were talking about oil dry. That is what he's running the broom over. You see him putting it down there. That absorbs oil. But one thing about it, when it's on the high side of the racetrack and you get in it, it's almost as slick as the oil you're trying to mop up.
Ralph Shaheen.
Again, we're with Chad Little. Chad, can you tell me what happened?
It's just, you know, restarts are always, you know, pins and needles. And everyone just slowed down. And one of those situations where it's just, guy in the middle can't slow down fast enough, and I got hit in the back and spun around and hit the wall and bounced back into the wall again. I mean, you know, that's just part of racing. You don't get upset about these things. I mean, we learned a lot today, and we really ran well. I'm happy for the team and for John Deere, and you know, it's that's what it's all about as well. We keep making improvements, and you know, we had a good day today. It's just, you can't help that kind of stuff. It's just racing luck.
Is it too much speedy dry out there?
No, I don't think the wreck was from speedy dry. If they would have went green the first time, it would have been. But, you know, we had two more laps of caution before we went green. So, but we're okay. We're just, we'll get back. And that's just part of racing. Nothing you can do about that.
Ken, Chad's going to have to get back on that pin cushion. His wife, Donna's at home. She's overdue with their first child.
Graduated from law school. A really great skier out of Spokane, Washington. But his heart is in racing, Chad Little.
Okay, you see Johnny Benson now. He gets up there, he loses the back coming off the corner. Now, you can see the speedy dry flying up in the air there. That's what I was basing my opinion on. But he actually lost the back end of the car coming out of the corner way before he got up where the oil dry was.
And you see the 42 hit the brakes, trying to avoid him. He took the outside, and then they...
Wow, they banged together pretty hard there after both of them had already wrecked.
Yeah, you take 50 miles an hour one way and 50 the other. That's a rugged hit. Benson loose.
Back end, ooh, just comes right
watch
by our
right
camera
here.
There.
That's Chad Little there in the green car. Sometimes you get lucky and go inside like that.
Whoa. That was Dale Jarrett that was riding with there, and he got lucky and made a good move as well.
Mr. Lucky, Dale Jarrett on that one.
For all concerned, I do like my job up here.
You're okay. You'll be all right. We'll be back with more from the Texas Motor Speedway with Buddy Baker and Ned Jarrett and Bolt. A great weekend for racing from the blockbuster view. This beautiful Texas Motor Speedway where all the seats, 150,000, are sold. All the suites across the top, a double row of them there, enjoying this race. Wonderful day for Winston Cup racing. And next weekend, all of the weekend, such a great time for golf. Next Sunday at 3, get a special look at the life and development of a new superstar, Tiger Woods, Sun Hero and Champion. Jim Nance narrates, and some of the greatest names in golf will be along. Byron Nelson for sure, and Arnold Palmer and Jack Nicklaus. Don't miss it. That's next week, along with our Masters coverage on CBS. Mike Joy.
A Texas-sized mile of duct tape has gone on the right front of Ward Burton's car. He got a piece of that incident, and they have now brought him in six times to add tape, not just to hold this together, but to try to make that car some semblance of aerodynamic. He is in ninth place. He's still on the lead lap. Dick Bergeron.
Well, Jarrett's day started out really well. He was on the pole. He ran terrifically, and then first it was a clutch. Now it's a transmission. He has lost third gear. They just brought this transmission from the truck out here to pit road. They're ready to change it if necessary. Meanwhile, they have called Todd Bodine on the radio and said, we don't have third gear. Don't run into the back of us when the green flag drops, because we're not going to be getting up to speed very quickly.
Well, that was the reason then that he didn't get that good restart on the last when we took green a few laps ago. So now he'll have to start in fourth gear. Good advice to give to those that are running behind you, and I'm sure that Todd Bodine will pay attention there.
Although Ricky Rudd leading that field down, Ned. He was 23rd at Darlington a couple of weeks back, trying to change his luck a little.
Let's talk about Ricky Rudd just a little bit. He has won one race at least every year since 1983. If he wins today, it'll be 15 years in a row that he has won a race.
That is incredible, really, in the type of competition we see now in this sport.
Ricky Rudd says, or has said, I probably do my best driving when I'm fired up. You can be sure that he's fired up right now.
Yeah, but he's got trouble right behind him there.
He's got a blowtorch right behind him. Terry Labonte racing what he considers his home track. Waited a long time to see this happen, to race in such a beautiful facility as they have here in the greater Dallas-Fort Worth area. We'll take a quick commercial break and then get back to it. We're showing 266 laps complete this time of 334.
This CBS Sports Race Summary is sponsored by the more than 1,525 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts and auto parts.
After 266 laps had been completed, 399 miles, there have been 10 leaders, 17 lead changes. Very slow race because 63 laps have been run under caution and eliminated 15 cars.
Yeah, it's been a wild afternoon. You can see those that are out of the race, the reasons, mostly crashes, a few engines. Here are more cars coming down pit road as we look at all of these drivers that are out of competition now. See more crashes here.
Let's go quickly to Dick Berggren.
Quickly, they're going to throw some fuel into Dale Earnhardt's car. Chocolate Myers in the back. He is, look at him, trying to get every possible drop of gas into this thing so that Earnhardt won't have to stop again. Todd Bodine did it. Jeff Burton did it. Dale Jarrett did it. They all came and topped off on fuel at the tail end of this caution period. Can they run to the end? Maybe. To Mike Joy.
There's a Texas-style shootout down here at the end of pit road. Ricky Rudd's guys are staring down at Gary Dehart and Terry Labonte's guys, and they're staring back. And one won't pit until the other one does. Who's going to draw first and see if they can gas and go the distance after this? Ralph?
Well, we've caught up with Johnny Benson, who's just come out of the infield care center. JB, you okay?
Yeah, I'm doing fine. I kind of hated that happen. I just flat lost it, and then, then I don't know what happened. I had my eyes closed at that point in time, so thought we were going to be okay. And I hit the inside one, stopped, and then Joe hit me. But Joe's doing all right. He's fine. He just said his chest hurts a little bit right here. And
what'd you say to him when you got out of the car?
I was just saying if he's all right. I mean, we both took a good hit, and I was just got out first, and he wasn't moving too quick. So I just checking on him to see if he's all right. It's been a pretty tough deal for the Nemechek's, and like I said, I just want to make sure everything is okay with him.
Leaders are pitting with 99 and a half miles to go. Leaders on pit road, Ricky Rudd and Terry Labonte. Mike Joy.
Labonte coming down the pit lane. Rudd's pit is further up pit road, so he'll be in first. The key is going to be gas. They have to get it all. Randy Hildreth is the gas man, and they have to get every drop because of the fuel window here. He is full. Labonte is full. Labonte is away first because Rudd didn't just go for gas. They are getting four tires. Ricky Rudd again using a contrary strategy to everybody else. He'll be the last car on the lead lap in line, but he has the freshest tires to go the distance.
Ninth place, nine cars in the lead lap.
And Dale Earnhardt came back in. He was in just two laps ago, but he came back in to top off, put back in what he burned out on those couple of laps under caution to have a better chance of finishing.
We'll take a quick commercial break and come back as the drama continues to build in this inaugural Interstate Batteries 500. Coming back, going under green. with 269 of the 334 laps run. Todd Bodine, number 25, is your leader. Jeff Burton, number 99, is in second. And Dale Jarrett, number 88, is in third. Bobby Labonte is in fourth. Wheeling down the back straightaway, coming back to speed. Terry Labonte fifth. Earnhardt, there he is in sixth and making a move on the inside for fifth. Ward Burton was in seventh. Then Ricky Rudd toward the tail end of that lap with Sterling Marlin.
Now, Ricky Rudd took on four tires during that last stop, but he had not taken on tires when the stop was before. That's how he got the lead.
And, buddy, take a look at Michael Waltrip trying to get that lap back in the 21.
Boy, nothing he would like better. He's been one of the quicker cars all day long, but he got a lap down, and you can see right now he may have a chance to get back in the lead lap here.
Nine cars in the lead lap. Waltrip, number 21, in 10th. His brother's car destroyed in an earlier incident today.
And Kenny Wallace right there also running in 11th place. He's right in front of Jeff Burton. Kenny Wallace in the blue and yellow, number 81. He has had a good run here today. He'd like to get back into the big place.
His best run of the year.
You're riding with Jeff Burton as they start down the back straightaway here. You can see him pull under Kenny Wallace and go down the back straightaway, trying to get that position. Kenny cuts him off going in the corner and saves that spot.
And remember that Jeff Burton is your second place car. Two cars in front of him are a lap down to that leader, Todd Bodine, in the number 25, who is having a great run.
Jarrett got off to a slow start again as a result of having to start in fourth gear, but he picked back up pretty quickly now as Jeff Burton tries to move on the inside of Kenny Wallace, but can't do it.
Look at that Yates car go down the back straightaway. Dale Jarrett flying down the straightaway.
They say there may be a little smoke out of that number 99 running in the second spot. Here he comes to the inside on Wallace. He's got Jarrett right behind him.
Wallace moves out of the way and lets him go.
Trying to make up that lap. Wasn't there. So he lets these guys through. Good move by Kenny Wallace. You see it. 60 laps left to go. 89 miles to decide. The Interstate Batteries 500 for $3.8 million. That's the divvy up this afternoon. Mike Joy.
Well, I asked Buddy Parrott, the crew chief from Jeff Burton. I said they said there might be a little smoke, and he just kind of laughed and got back on the radio with Jeff. They're not concerned about that. Tell you who is concerned right now is Terry Labonte. His car's not handling well. He says, if we get a caution, I need four tires.
Look at Jeff Burton move in on Todd Bodine. He caught him five car lengths in one corner there. This car is on a mission. It might be smoking, but I tell you something else it's doing. It's flying.
Chevy Ford battle up in front. Todd Bodine a little high. Jeff Burton comes in on him.
Contact there.
There goes Bodine into the wall, spinning. Fighting for the lead. He's down at the bottom. He gathers it up. Is caution coming out? Yes, it is. And there's another car crossed up in the back straightaway. But for Todd Bodine, this one's over. As a couple of young horses got on it here in Texas.
I understand late speed was also involved in the car number 9. And you can see the damage to Todd Bodine's car.
Lake Speed was having a great run. He was in 13th at the time, there actually in 12th.
See, his left front tire is flat.
The 99, Jeff Burton into the lead. This is as wild as a Saturday night special.
I'd like to add to that. I know it looked like Jeff Burton just run over him coming up out of the corner, but he had a tremendous run. And when he started out, a lot of times these cars, the front end will take off on you just a little bit. And he was into the car of Todd Bodine before he could even react.
Dick Bergeron.
What a disappointing weekend for this group. Todd Bodine has overshot his pit, the left side of the car, heavy damage, tail end of the car, heavy damage. This thing is so beat up they can't even get a jack underneath it. The crew is leaning hard, trying to lift the car off the ground. There they go. Now they've got it so they can get the jack underneath, get those flat tires off it, and try to go to work on it. He had been in the lead. Oh, the crew says hold it. Oh, brake rotor broken right in half. That is a major problem. They're going to have to fix that. He's got no brakes whatsoever at the moment.
There's the culprit. That's going to put the number 25 out of commission with just a few laps to go. Leaders back on pit road. Earnhardt is in. Labonte, Ricky Rudd, Sterling Marlin, and the 21 car, Michael Waltrip, all making their pit stops. Mike Joy.
Terry Labonte got his wish. He got a caution, and he'll get his four tires. They top off the fuel. Ricky Rudd tops off fuel, and he's the first car off of pit road. Walter Smith brings that jack around, and with one pump, the car's in the air. And very quickly, four fresh tires. No different in compound or rubber or construction than the ones that came off. Maybe a little different in air pressure, and hopefully for Terry, a little different in handling.
Here's what happened.
Okay, the two lead cars, Todd Bodine and the red 25 in front. Here's Jeff Burton down on the inside. They come off turn two, moving in close, a little bit of contact right there, and it broke the car number 25 loose, and around he goes.
I'd love to see a replay again of that. I think what happened, it looked like Todd Bodine may have lost the back just a little bit. Just watch the back right there. You see the car right there wiggle just a little bit. That broke a little bit of his momentum. Awfully hard to call when they're that close, though.
See Lake Speed getting on the binders and spinning.
Whew. Boy, it comes by that camera in a hurry, doesn't it?
Ned, I've been sitting there looking at that coming at me before.
Watching the world spinning by. Todd Bodine, here's Dale Jarrett's view. That's the third time today that Dale Jarrett has escaped what looked to be disaster.
Unfortunately.
Did look like that 25 kicked out, didn't it?
Kicked out a little bit. I think he broke his momentum, and Jeff Burton had such a run off the corner, he just got into it.
Ralph Jaheen.
Well, we're down here at the Infield Care Center where Joe Nemechek has just now walked out. Joe, are you okay? You took a hard lick.
Yes, I'm fine. Stretched my sternum out a little bit. Hit Johnny Benson pretty hard. Not sure what happened. I saw him spin up front, and all of a sudden I got turned around from behind. Can't say enough for the whole Bell South crew. They've been working hard. We've had some good cars. Had a good run going today, just kind of hanging in there and just can't be in the right spot at the right time. But we'll have some luck soon.
Good guy.
What a positive attitude, even under all these circumstances.
280 laps complete. We'll take a quick commercial break at 420 miles. Just 80 miles to go to decide it, with nine competitors all wanting to set the pace.
CBS Sports presentation of the Interstate Batteries 500 is sponsored by Napa Auto Parts. We keep America running. And by MCI. Is this a great time or what?
One lap has gone by since they've gone back to green. We have 283 of 334 now complete, and there is your leader, number 99 for Roush Racing, Jeff Burton. The other two Roush cars blew up today. Present time, you have Dale Jarrett in second, Bobby Labonte in third.
And Dale Earnhardt just moved into fourth. No. Yes, behind, around the Ward Burton car, Earnhardt came in, topped off the fuel, has new tires. He is on the move.
Rudd is back in six.
If you want to see what Jeff Burton's looking at, this is looking out of the back of his car. Not much view back there. Nobody's close enough to even get in the picture right at the moment.
Rudd in six. Then you have Terry Labonte now in seventh. And Sterling Marlin in eight. One lap down, Michael Waltrip. Ralph Jaheen.
Todd Bodine has climbed out of the Budweiser car. Todd, it's hard to tell from the replay. Did you get touched, or did you just lose it on your own in the loose stuff?
Well, I didn't get off the corner as fast as Jeff was gonna, that's for sure. He was a lot better, and I wasn't gonna race him. I was gonna let him go because he was that good, but I think I got a little bit of help. I know he didn't mean to do it. It's one of those things that happened. It's a shame. I mean, we were doing what we set out to do. That was have a decent day, be solid all day, consistent, stay out of trouble, and be around at the end, and we were there. We did what we were supposed to do, and it's really a shame for these guys and for Rick Hendrick and this whole organization to get taken out of a race like this. We had a top five finish going, and it's banged up here in the garage.
Hendrick Motorsports needed a solid replacement for Ricky Craven. They had one in Todd Bodine.
He was solid today. The guy that's out in front now is Jeff Burton. They'll be talking about that one for some time to come. Here's Mike Joy.
Well, Ken, everybody has a different version. Jeff Burton called his crew and said, I never touched Todd Bodine. The Todd got up in the loose stuff and tried to hold his line, didn't back off, exceeded the slip angle of the tires. They wouldn't grip, and he went to the wall. Jeff says, never laid a bumper on him.
I buy that story. I thought there was a little space in there. We'll see. We'll hear a lot more about it, you can be sure. But Jeff Burton, for the moment, who says his theory on racing is very simple, has the lead. You don't make yourself any better by getting in over your head. He says there are times you can drive over your head, look really good, and there are a lot of times you look like an idiot. I've come to the conclusion you can't do any good doing that. Right now he's looking very good.
Well, he looks good, but Dale Jarrett looks good too. If anything, he's closing in some on Jeff Burton as we speak, and Earnhardt's on a tear too. You can see him there in the three car as they start down the back straightaway. He just got by Ward Burton in the 22, and you can see Terry Labonte going by Ricky Rudd down in turn three.
Mm-hmm. Here comes Labonte on a roll. The difference is 2 8/10 seconds between first and second place as you ride with Bobby Labonte, the third place car. And that's one of those Pontiacs that early in the day we were talking about. This just might be the occasion for them to take a checker. Joe Gibbs, number 18, driven by Bobby Labonte. Another one of that Texas crowd from Corpus Christi coming on strong here at the finish.
Still have about 45 laps to go.
Jeff Burton out in front trying to score his first win in his 96 start. There he goes down across the line another time. Difference, 2/10 has been picked up by Jarrett. Now it's 2.6, it was 2.8. Jarrett closing in. Laps, well, we're at lap 290 of 334 right now. Peeling them off, Ned.
Peeling them off, that's a long way to go, but not nearly as long as they've had.
You can see Jarrett running right around the base of the racetrack. Terry Labonte took advantage of the caution a while ago and got a set of tires, and buddy, he is motoring now.
He has a lot of good race cars to pass, but he's in sixth position right now. Terry Labonte is trying to take over fifth.
290 laps complete, 65 miles to go, and here comes Terry. Here comes Rudd.
They both passed Ward Burton, and they talked about the damage that Ward Burton had on his car from being involved in an altercation a little bit earlier. So aerodynamics probably not what he needs for it to be.
That moves Terry into fifth, as you can see right there. And I tell you, in one lap, look what a gap he's put on Ward Burton. This car is on a mission right now. Terry Labonte is so smooth. He will not abuse his race car, but he will put it to the hammer, I guarantee you right now.
Burton picks it up. It's now 2 7/10 seconds. Gained a couple of tenths back, at least one full tenth back. Jeff Burton getting away for a moment from Jarrett. Bearing down, trying to close in. Just behind those guys in the lead lap. Marlin drops it off at eighth. Michael Waltrip in ninth. Grissom is now 10th. Jeff Bodine is 11th. Bill Elliott is 12th. And John Andretti. John Andretti has come up into 13th with Kenny Wallace 14th and Dave Marcus in that number 71 you always see out there. He's up to 15th. Boy, wouldn't it be good to see Dave Marcus have a day.
Yeah, top 15 would be a good day for Dave Marcus. He doesn't have the big buck funding that most of these teams have. Just a hard-working individual, does a lot of the work on the race car himself, and just having a good run here today.
Last of the old breed. All right, you got 40 laps to go, 65 miles, and here's Mike Joy.
Ken, at the top of the show, we showed you that NASCAR had taken away another quarter inch of rear spoiler height from the Fords and cost them about 60 pounds of rear downforce, looking for parity among makes. Right now, Fords are in first, second, sixth, and ninth among the top 10, so perhaps the rule change was a good one. Bill Gasaway, the former competition director for NASCAR, when asked how did he know when he had a level playing field, he said, when everybody's complaining, just a little.
Terry Labonte not complaining right there as he gets another Chevy. I tell you, Labonte is as quick as anything out there. Let's put a clock on Terry Labonte and see how fast he's tripping around this mile and a half.
If you look Ricky Rudd's moving right along with him. I think Dale Earnhardt is off just a little bit right now in the handling area, because you can see Ricky Rudd passed him in one straightaway there and starting to move away.
But Earnhardt really took off on this restart, gained several positions, and I thought, man, he's headed towards the front. But now that it's getting a little heat in those tires, I don't think that he's quite pleased with the way the car is driving.
Kerry Labonte, number 5, goes to 4th, and number 10, Rudd to 5th. Earnhardt is 6th in the number 3. Jeff Burton working on that first win. Can it happen here, this first time at Texas? Be like when Joe Lee Johnson won that first race ever in 1960 in Charlotte.
There's a factor that we don't have here. The first Charlotte race had the racetrack tore all the pieces at Charlotte. This is a wonderful racetrack. But if you get out of the groove, it's really collected some great race cars today.
You saw that interval between first and second, between Jeff Burton and Dale Jarrett, and that stands at 2.6, the difference between this number 99, the Ford from Roush Racing, and the Ford from Yates Racing running in that second spot. There they are going around Jeff Gordon again in the 24. And let's see, he's picked up enough laps now. Only 83 laps down to 31st position.
Yeah, he's picked up about 3 positions since he's gone back out there, Ken. And that's they're three points per position back in that area. So that you never know what that might do at the end of the year.
Hey, Ned. Jeff Burton's last lap, 177.4. Terry Labonte's last lap, 178.3.
Well, Terry Labonte, with those new tires, is definitely running a little bit faster.
Yeah.
But he has a long way to go to catch Jeff Burton.
I don't think that's the issue right now. The two brothers are fixing to go to war back there for position. Terry has moved right in on the back bumper of his brother as we watch the leader go down the back straightaway.
To Dick Berggren.
Dale Earnhardt's team came into this morning with more optimism for any race since Daytona way back in February. But right now, Richard Childress, owner of the car, it's not handling well. What's the matter?
Well, you know, we got the nose knocked in on this last caution, and, you know, it just got a real, real bad push on it right now. We don't know if it's this set of tires in particular is the stagger or what, but we're just, if we get a caution, we'll try to fix it.
What will you do to it on a caution?
Put 4 more scuffs on it and try to pull the nose back out.
Well, for the Earnhardt fans, it's still been a good day. He's right up front for the first time in a long time. Ken?
Well, there are the Labonte brothers at it again. There's Bobby Labonte, the younger brother, in the Joe Gibbs number 18, and right with them comes the number 5, Terry Labonte.
3rd and 4th.
First racing experience for those two in go-karts. Bobby lined up behind Terry, and their dad told Bobby to follow his older brother, Terry, get used to racing. Bobby passed Terry. He wouldn't let Terry back by. Afterwards, his father asked, hey, why he'd not followed instructions, and Bobby said, hey, what do you think, Dad? I wanted to win.
And both of them have been winners, still are winners. Another great family in NASCAR Winston Cup Racing.
Well, I can tell you, he's got a royal job if he's going to keep Terry Labonte behind him right now, because Terry's car is probably the fastest car on the track. But like you said, Ned, he has some ground to make up to catch the leader.
He's more than 5 seconds behind Jeff Burton, who is leading this race.
And Burton has pulled away from Jarrett. It's now better than 3 seconds between first and second spot. The battle is here between the Texans. 3rd and 4th spot, Ralph Shaheen.
Jimmy Makar is the crew chief for Bobby Labonte. Can he hold off his big brother, Jimmy?
I don't know. You know, it's a little bit of time left to go. Our car is not really handled great all day long. We've been struggling with it. He got his handful of turns. Been good all day long. So time to see what they can do. Hopefully he can hold them off. But Terry's strong right now.
Mike Joy.
Terry Labonte is markedly faster than the race leader, Jeff Burton, and a good reason why. Buddy Parrott has pulled the reins in on Burton. He had him running laps at 30 flat, 30.05. That's 30.05 seconds. And now Parrott has had Burton back off even further. He wants him at about 30.25 seconds to slow the pace to save the tires. If Burton has one problem, it's vision. Turn number 1 is now fully shaded. And with oil on the windshield, Burton says it's all dark and shadowy. Every time I go in there, I can't see a thing going into that corner.
Of course, Mike, if he backing off a little bit too, which he can do and run that speed and stay out front comfortable. You can see his problem looking out that windshield, but he's also conserving a little bit of fuel, and I think he's going to run close as far as fuel is concerned.
Yeah, it looked like midnight. You could see when you run into the shadows there, the entire car got dark inside. So vision and readjusting your eyes when you go into dark like that, it's hard to get your vision properly as you start in one.
Well, we've had tire wars, we've had car wars, we've had Star Wars for sure out here. Today we've got battery wars as the XI car continues to lead. And that's Jeff Burton out in front, the Interstate car coming on.
CBS Sports presentation of the Interstate Batteries 500 is sponsored by Miller Lite, who reminds you that anything can happen at Miller time. Havoline Formula 3 motor oil. Add more life to your car. And by Genuine Chevrolet, the cars more Americans trust.
Down to the finish. Shadows getting long over the new Texas Motor Speedway. But it's a very bright day for Jeff Burton, continuing to lead by 3.5 seconds. The veteran of South Boston, Virginia short track racing, who's made the move up through the ranks from the Sportsman into the Grand National, now in Winston Cup racing, may put Jack Roush back in the victory circle today. A 3.5 second advantage over Dale Jarrett in second, Bobby Labonte in third, Terry Labonte in fourth. There you see that interval between first and second spot. Back to Dale Jarrett. Transmission problems over the last half of the race, but he's still very much in it. Jarrett trying for his third Super Speedway win this year in Winston Cup racing. And there's your battle for third spot, the Labonte brothers.
Pontiac number 18 of Bobby and the Chevrolet number 5 of Terry. They've sort of stabilized there. Terry ran up on Bobby about 10, 15 laps ago, but hasn't been able to do much with him since then. Of course, we had a report that Terry's car might be a little bit tight right now, not getting off the corners the way that we'd like.
20 laps to go. 20 laps to decide a $3.8 million payoff in this first race on this new facility in Texas. There's Jeff Burton just squeezing the trigger in between lap cars. Jeff Burton, bright young new star in Winston Cup racing, hopes to take that first big win here today.
Boy, this would be a big one, Ken, if he can pull it off here today.
29 years of age. About his long-range plans in racing, Jeff Burton told Mike Mulhern over at the Winston-Salem Journal, he said, hey, I have a problem with people trying to plot a course in life. This isn't navigating. This isn't a deal where you can say, okay, we're going to do this or we're going to do that. This is a deal that not only makes changes week to week, but minute to minute and in seconds. Your whole game plan for your life can change, and I don't have a crystal.
Well, I can tell you one thing. When he signed up with Jack Roush and got Buddy Parrott as the crew chief, Jeff Burton's stock went way, way up.
Dick Bergren.
And you know, the team concept is ever so important. And if you want to look for two of the brighter guys in this league, you just found them in Jeff Burton and in Buddy Parrott. They really understand this sport. They don't let emotion get in the way. They are constantly calculating, thinking, and trying to get ahead of everybody else. When they had an open test, they brought the car they ran so well at Darlington, but they felt it didn't have enough downforce, so they brought the car that they've got today. Thinking all the time. This is indeed a thinking man's game. You got two of the best in the world in that 99 team.
You see Morgan Shepherd's number one, still looking for a sponsor. They're back in 24th position. Morgan's had some good runs this year. And there you see the 97 back on the track, Chad Little, after that car was in a big crunch earlier. But the 99, Burton's the one that may be making history.
Talking about thinking, I think your second place car is doing the same thing. There's a big picture here. He is a points leader. He made a run at Jeff Burton just a little while ago, did not close in on him. Now I think he is looking at the big picture, trying to get the second place salvage. Right at the moment, I don't think he can really close in on Jeff Burton.
Here's Dale Jarrett trying to hold on to that championship lead. Be with you at Michigan for the 400 there on CBS. Looking forward in Winston Cup racing to show you the Talladega Diehard 500. That's coming up later this year, Ned. Different time of the year to get down there on that big 2.6
October the 12th, my birthday.
15 laps to go here this afternoon as Jeff Burton stays out in front. There they are, putting a lap on the guy who was contending for the lead until he was knocked out of this race right here in the main straightaway.
That was Jeff Gordon.
31st. Looking back, the interval stays at 3.7.
I was just watching Jeff Burton's car head into turn three just a second ago, and looks like he might have a little vibration there. I don't know whether it certainly is not slowing him down anyway, but I noticed the back there was shaking a little bit at the end of the back straightaway.
3 3/10 between first and second, and here he is behind two cars. Dick Trickle in the number 90 down on the inside. Had a good run going a lot of the afternoon. It's backed up into 23rd spot, and Schrader in the 33.
Schrader is running in the 18th position.
Mike Joy.
One of the greatest of the East Coast racers of all time, Eddie Flemke, had an axiom: run just slow enough to win. Buddy Parrott has backed Jeff Burton off even further. His race pace has slowed to 30.5 seconds per lap, and it looks like Parrott is going to allow all of Burton's lead to be eaten up just right to the checkered flag. They are sure they can win this race.
3 4/10 of a second now. Jarrett trims back Burton just a bit. Jack Roush, who owns that 99, hasn't won a race for that team since October 95 at Charlotte. Mark Martin pulled it off. Here he is under Mike Wallace in the number 91. Wallace up in this field today. Where's he running? About 17th? 16th, 17th. Jeff Burton stays in front. That lead stays now at 3 2. 3.2 as the 88 continues to close him down.
Depends on where they catch traffic, Ken. Both of them have been in some heavy traffic here for the last several laps. And depends on where you catch them now. Probably went up that lap because Jarrett got caught in some traffic off of turns 3 and 4.
Well, you see the two Labonte brothers there. The leader right there is Bobby Labonte, and that's Terry Labonte in the number 5. You know, he caught him, run him down full straightaway, run right up on his back bumper, and all of a sudden they stabilized.
3rd and 4th.
10 laps to go for Jeff Burton.
Jeff Burton says the driver is as much a part of this deal as anything, but it's all got to work. Part of the driver's job is to make it work, but when it doesn't, the fault isn't all the driver's.
Just exactly what this guy's going through right here. I won my first major race at Charlotte, North Carolina, sister track to this brand new facility. Right now, he knows it's his race if he does not mess up.
And that car holds together.
Wear on you a little?
Oh, yeah, you can hear everything in that race car. When you get down and have a nice lead with 9 laps to go, you can hear everything in that car starting to move around somewhat.
Doctor, your first win?
My first win was on a dirt track in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina.
It's now a paved
track.
Not
nearly as big as this right now. Paid $900 for me.
Back in 59.
Yeah.
When Baker won his first race, he stopped Richard Petty's mark. Remember Petty won all those races in 67? Huh? Something like 10 or 11 races? Knocked him right off, and then there you were, messed him up.
Yeah, right. He had 27 wins, and I won my first one. That tells you something.
Yeah, Richard won 10 in a row that year. That's the record.
With Buddy Baker, Ned Jarrett, I'm Ken Squire. What a thrill it has been to be here today to watch this race. And now the question is, can Jeff Burton hold on and win his first Winston Cup race? Can he go in the history book as winning the inaugural event at this $120 million Palace of Speed that Bruton Smith has built just west of Dallas-Fort Worth? There you see the 25 back out again. Todd Bodine, they've got that brake fixed, and they've got him back out for these final laps.
You know, at one time, everybody said Ward Burton was the man to watch in the Burton family, and that Jeff had a lot to go to catch up to his brother. He won Rockingham a couple of years ago, Jeff did. But look at this. Ward Burton's proven his worth now. What a great race.
That's his wife, Kim, looking on. A lot of years, a lot of waiting, a lot of determination on this driver's part. And you can be sure a lot of tears away from the track on those nights when things didn't come out the way may this afternoon.
Oh, he deserves a victory. There's no doubt about it.
Dale Jarrett, now 4 7/10 seconds back. unless something goes awry, and it has on the other two Roush cars, both expired with engine trouble. Jeff Burton is going to win his first race in this first race at Texas.
Bobby Labonte beginning to close in a little bit on Dale Jarrett now. He's closed it down from 3 seconds down to two.
And he's pulled away from him. He's passing him coming off the corner over there.
He's passing him. Yeah, but he's pulled away from his brother Terry by about 7 or 8 car lengths.
Boy, it does look dark in the main straightaway. That is shadow. It is not that dark. It's a bit of an optical illusion there. Four to go. Right. Four to go for Jeff Burton. Four, the longest laps of his career.
Quite a shot there. You can see he's very relaxed in the cockpit, holding the steering wheel pretty still in the corner. And right now, emotion is driving that race car.
There's still 8 cars on the lead lap. Anxiety. Pray.
Kim Burton looking on as Jeff with 3 laps to go. Never forget 95 North Wilkesboro. Got hit in the driver's door, and that drove that hot exhaust stack right up in. Blue fumes on him like a blowtorch. They had to give him IV and oxygen when it was over, but he finished.
Jeff's wife, I guarantee you this is like 4 days to her. You could see her fanning herself there. Emotion very, very high.
Bobby Labonte is close to within 1.2 seconds on Dale Jarrett. And Terry now has caught back up to Bobby.
Rudd lies fifth, Earnhardt sixth. Ward Burton, the brother of Jeff Burton, the elder brother, in seventh. Then Marlin in eighth. Michael Waltrip still that lap down in ninth. Madeer, get ready for new territory. One lap to go. You are headed for victory lane if that engine holds together for one more lap at around 177 miles an hour.
He's got himself a big lead. Take no chances of coming up on Jeff Bodine there, but he don't need to pass Jeff. Just follow him around there, Jeff Burton.
4 7/10 of a second between first and second spot. Give a call to Steve Grissom. Back up here in 10th spot. Elliott 11th. Checkers coming down. The inaugural Interstate Batteries 500 at the Texas Motor Speedway is won by South Boston, Virginia's Jeff Burton. What a job.
Oh, that's wonderful. Really, that's a great win.
If you got to have a breakthrough, what a way to do it.
With the eyes of the racing world on this event here today, this is the way to do it.
Did anybody mention $320,000 to win?
Did anybody mention Buddy Parrott, crew chief? He was growing a beard for a big motorcycle tour starting tomorrow. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, there's a lot of emotion down here. I know the tears of joy. How do you feel right now?
Unbelievable. He just worked so hard. This is what he wanted all his life. I'm so happy for him.
Well, you got to go enjoy victory lane.
Jeff Burton on his way. Take the best trip there is in motorsports. You're riding with him, getting ready to find himself a place in the record book. That place that comes to special people. Johnny Mantz, Darlington. Jeff Gordon, Indianapolis, the Brickyard 400. Lee Petty, Daytona 1959. And today in Texas, the name is that of a Virginian, Jeff Burton. He's done Virginia proud. So the younger Parrott brother, crew chief for the second place car, has to look up to old dad. But he put it on him then.
Sure did today.
By 4 seconds. Mike Joy is awaiting your winner.
He called his crew chief, Ken, on the cool-off lap and said, "Where do I go?"
Buddy Barrett says, just come on in, I'll show you. Hey, guys, Tony, give me a little room here. Jeff Burton, finally, victory lane, undefeated in Texas. How's it feel?
Hell, I don't know. Feels pretty good. This team's been working really hard. We've lost more than we won, that's for sure. We've given a few away. We didn't give this one away.
Buddy Parrott backed you down those last 50 laps, and then you took control of the race pace back with about 10 to go. Don't give me lap times, just give me the interval. Let me know what I got.
Well, it really didn't matter how fast we could run. It only mattered where the other guys were, and it was a matter of just being patient and, you know, not screwing up. It's something. There's sometimes all you can do is mess up. And
I got a crying lady here who wants to talk to you. Don't you just love a first-time winner? She cried the whole last 20 laps, almost like she was driving this car.
She may as well have been driving this car. She's been right there with me through all the good times and bad times, so she may as well be driving.
What a great day for you folks. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Dick Bergeron.
Dale Jarrett here at the gas pumps. You ought to be smiling, my friend. You're lucky to finish this thing with all the troubles that you had. How'd you do it?
I don't know. Just good Lord was with us. We had a lot of problems here today, and you know, the guys did a terrific job in the pits. We lost the clutch there before halfway, and so I was having to get out of the pits and on restarts, try to be careful. It was pretty tough, and then we lost third gear on a restart, so I was having to go from second to fourth. And this is a good race car, good race team, and when you got those things, you do good things. I want to congratulate Jeff Burton. He did a great job. He was fast all day long. He's been wanting to win a race for a long time. And congratulations to those guys. They did an awesome job.
And Dale Jarrett's been wanting to win a championship for a long time, and he's got the points to do it in the beginning of the season, at least. To Ralph Shaheen.
Bobby Labonte, you wanted to race your brother at the end of this one, but you did it. Not for the win, unfortunately. Tell me about the battle.
The Interstate Pontiac, we were decent all day. We just didn't have enough for the top two cars, and at times we didn't have enough for the top 10 cars. It just seemed like just the differences on tires and the racetrack was a little different at times. It made a big difference. But man, I tell you what, you know, I know what Jeff Burton's going through. I won my first one at a big track like this, and everybody needs to win one. I mean, it's great. So congratulations to those guys, and you know, we're lucky we came out with third without a scratch on it. We'll go to Bristol and see what we can do.
And here at the Texas Motor Speedway, the winner is Jeff Burton. Look at the standings. Great weekend for Roush Racing. Mark Martin wins for them yesterday. Jeff Burton comes home first today. Take a look.
See the finishing order. Todd Bodine did get back out there and salvaged a 14th place finish here today. And Dave Marcus came home in 15th. That was great to see him. And Billy Standridge with the 21st place finish.
10 cautions, 73 laps under yellow, 12 cars eliminated, and some wild incidents.
You know something? There's certain things in racing that just make you feel good. Today made me feel good.
Great to see a first-time winner, and Jeff Burton deserved it. I mean, he ran for it, ran hard, and deserved to win.
Representative of all those short tracks across America, a new name out of the old South Boston Speedways, pulled it off today. And we'll be back after this word from your local stations. Winston Cup point leaders moving to Bristol. Jarrett in front. And the Labonte's coming on. Jeff Gorton takes a big slide today. But the story in the Lone Star State of Texas is there's a new star in Winston Cup racing. What a grand show we've had.
Boy, it was an interesting race all day, very competitive, and a lot of action certainly for the fans here.
Final word, buddy?
Well, I just thought maybe we wouldn't have a race when they all went down in the first corner. I said, wow, this is pretty rugged, but I'll tell you what, everybody worked hard. Great race. Couldn't have been better. Congratulations to Jeff Burton.
And to Jack Roush, folks. For Ned Jarrett, Buddy Baker, Mike Joy, Dick Bergeron, Ralph Shaheen, Ken Squire saying so long from the new Texas Motor Speedway, where Jeff Burton has won the inaugural Interstate Batteries 500.
This has been a presentation of CBS Sports, home of the Daytona 500.